Today, over 3 million Palestinians are living under a brutal and illegal Israeli military occupation in the West Bank and East Jerusalem. And in the Gaza Strip, another 2 million Palestinians are being subjected to a devastating Israeli siege and blockade. Israel has methodically stolen Palestinian land in direct violation of international law, demolished Palestinian homes, built Jewish-only settlements, and imprisoned Palestinians in their own land by surrounding them with walls, military watchtowers, and checkpoints, denying them freedom of movement and visiting routine daily humiliation on them. Within Israel itself, 1.6 million Palestinian citizens of Israel, or nearly 20% of Israel's total population, live under a system of racial discrimination that meets the United Nations' definition of apartheid. While another 6.5 million Palestinians live as refugees or exiles outside of Israel, a result of the more than 750,000 Palestinians who fled or were driven from their homes when the State of Israel was established in 1948 and have been denied the right to return ever since. At the same time, Palestinians living in Gaza have endured successive Israeli bombardments, most recently in 2014, when Israel killed more than 2,000 Palestinians, a quarter of them children. Israel has only been able to continue these systematic violations of Palestinian human rights because of the support and complicity of international governments and corporations. And this is why, in 2005, Palestinian civil society launched the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement, or BDS, modeling itself on the nonviolent anti-apartheid movement targeting South Africa in the 1980s and the civil rights movement in the United States in the 1960s. BDS calls for boycotting Israel until it complies with international law by ending its illegal military occupation of Palestinian land, recognizing the full equality of Palestinian citizens of Israel, and assuring the right of Palestinian refugees to return to their homes. Since its founding, the BDS movement has inspired people around the world to take action against Israel and to stand alongside the Palestinian people in solidarity. It's become especially active on American college campuses. But while the movement has grown and won the support of progressive Jewish organizations like Jewish Voice for Peace, it has also inspired a fierce backlash from pro-Israel advocates in the U.S. who claim BDS delegitimizes Israel and is anti-Semitic.
I think we all know what it's designed to do. It's designed to delegitimize Israel.
BDS is part of a more generalized effort to destroy the state of Israel.
The movement itself, its intent, its goals, are anti-Semitic.
These claims have been heard from across the political spectrum.
There's only one word for it, anti-Semitism. Let us call out the BDS movement for what it is.
We must also be vigilant against bigoted or dangerous ideologies masquerading as policy, and that includes BDS.
And this rhetoric is now being backed up with a range of policies that aim to actually criminalize pro-Palestinian speech and activism in the U.S.
We turn now to the ongoing crackdown on pro-Palestinian activism here in the United States.
The U.S. House of Representatives overwhelmingly passed a resolution condemning BDS as anti-Semitic. 27 states have passed anti-BDS legislation, and elected American representatives such as Rashida Tlaib and Ilhan Omar have been denied entry to Israel and viciously smeared as anti-Semites in mainstream media for their support of BDS and Palestinian rights.
Two of the most virulent anti-Semites to ever hold public office. That would be Congresswoman Tlaib and Congresswoman Omar, who are obsessed with hating Israel.
Cutting off aid to Israel because of two people that hate Israel and hate Jewish people. I can't believe we're even having this conversation.
This is a woman who, by the way, called you a white supremacist, and the irony there is that if she wasn't a member of Congress, she'd be a member of the KKK.
In the midst of this accelerating crackdown on pro-Palestinian voices, one of the few places left where Israel's violations of Palestinian rights can be debated and discussed is the American campus. And that's exactly why Trump-supporting billionaires like Sheldon Adelson and New England Patriots owner Robert Kraft are funding right-wing lobbying efforts to combat BDS and pro-Palestinian activism on U.S. campuses. And it's why the U.S. government is now aggressively policing how Israel is talked about in the classroom.
The Trump administration's threatening to cut federal funding to a Middle East studies program. Education Secretary Betsy DeVos ordered a probe after North Carolina Republican Congressman George Holding accused the program of having a, quote, severe anti-Israeli bias and anti-Semitic rhetoric, unquote.
In addition to new Trump administration policies targeting American colleges and universities, prominent academics and advocates for BDS and Palestinian human rights from other countries are being denied visas to visit American universities.
They're involved in true McCarthyism, with loyalty to Israel being the litmus test. But Israel is certainly spying on U.S. citizens who are active in the BDS movement. Several of Israel's lobby groups are funding the so-called Canary Mission, which is smearing activists on campus, especially Jewish activists who support Palestinian rights.
And on this very campus, right-wing watchdog groups have targeted faculty who teach about Israel's human rights violations, and have attempted to vilify and shut down events at UMass that focus on the crackdown on pro-Palestinian speech. And tonight's event is no exception. Attacked once again by right-wing groups, and this time around even publicly condemned by the chancellor of this university.
Tenure is under attack. Our jobs are under attack. Our lives are under attack.
But as last May's event showed, those fighting for Palestinian human rights will not be silenced and are not backing down.
But we are committed to paying that price. We must all be committed to paying that price.
And I will tell you, as a Palestinian American, as a daughter and granddaughter and great-great-great-granddaughter of Palestinians, that I will not be silenced. I will not be intimidated. And I will continue to stand strong in my position.
Good evening and welcome to this special event, Criminalizing Dissent, the Attack on BDS and Pro-Palestinian Speech. I am Sat Jali, Professor of Communication at UMass and Executive Director of the Media Education Foundation. If you didn't know what the attack on BDS referred to, the nonviolent boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement against Israel's flagrant violation of international law, I think that opening video is a pretty good demonstration. And I hope that by the time you leave here today, you'll have a very good and clear idea of what BDS is, and more importantly, what it is not, and why it terrifies the defenders of Israel's indefensible actions against the Palestinian people. First, a little background. This is a follow-up event, as the video indicated, to one that took place here in May, entitled Not Backing Down. Many of you, I know, were here for that, and people have described it as one of the most electrifying and exhilarating events they've ever experienced. You must probably also know that it was the subject of a failed lawsuit to prevent it happening in the first place. So when we conceived of this follow-up event, we initially chose the subject matter as dealing with the close links of solidarity that exist between the African American freedom struggle and the Palestinian freedom struggle. But as wider events started to unfold, we realized that there was something much more timely and urgent to focus on, and that was the unrelenting attacks that were occurring on free speech to prevent any honest discussion of Israel's illegal military occupation of Palestine and its stranglehold of Gaza even taking place. In fact, speaking critically about the policies of the Israeli state towards Palestinians seemed to be increasingly criminalized. As the opening video makes clear, the attacks were coming from everywhere, from Congress, from state legislators, from the corporate media, from the very White House itself. The reason that BDS co-founder Omar Barghouti is appearing via webcam tonight and not in person is because he is banned from entering the country, banned from entering the United States. In this situation, about the only place left in the society where you can talk honestly about Israel-Palestine is the American campus. And it's for this reason that universities and colleges now are under a sustained right-wing attack to ban criticism of Israel on campus. And there are billions of dollars being expended on that effort. The autonomy and independence of the campus is under real threat. And the only acceptable administrative response should be an explicit and strong defense of its faculty and of academic freedom. A really good example of how to respond to intimidation is provided by Duke University President Vincent Price and its provost Sally Cornbluth. When the Trump administration, when the Trump Department of Education, under the leadership of Betsy DeVos, applied financial pressure to Duke University for not being pro-Israeli enough in its programs, Prince and Cornbluth were unequivocal in their response. Quote, "We want to be very clear. No outside entity will determine what Duke faculty will teach, how they teach it, what they choose to research or write about, or who can speak on our campus. Be assured that we will continue to be vigilant in protecting and advancing academic freedom at Duke," unquote. Any administrative response less forceful in this climate is a capitulation to reactionary forces. As one of my colleagues from Michigan remarked, one difference between a great university and a middling one is its staunch support of its faculty's freedom of expression. So when we announced that the event tonight would focus on the increasing attacks on pro-Palestinian speech, and BDS in particular, we knew there would be pushback, and we were prepared for the predictable attacks that came from the usual right-wing groups. We just did not think the attack would also be internal and come from our own chancellor. In an astonishing statement that he did not have to make, the Chancellor Swaboswamy, while adhering to First Amendment principles and not canceling the event, then went on to list every right-wing talking point about BDS and the Palestine freedom struggle to argue that the planned event, this event, was troubling and disturbing and did not have a place at UMass. But perhaps the most disturbing aspect of his statement was the framing of this event as one that was organized by a sinister outside organization designed to divide and polarize the campus. This was especially puzzling to me, as I was one of the main organizers, and I know, I've only been teaching here for the last 35 years. In addition, the co-sponsor and organizer of the event is Professor Stellan Vinthagen, and the UMass Academic Unit who directs the Resistance Studies Initiative. Also, Professor Amilcar Shabazz of the African American Studies Studies Program was one of the people organizing this event. Now, whatever else you may think of this event, of this gathering tonight, it is clearly driven by the scholarly interests of those of us who are an integral part of the intellectual and scholarly fabric of this campus. And so my question is, why would the Chancellor deliberately frame things in this disingenuous way and imply that the issues we are going to examine are not legitimate topics for discussion at a public university? Why would he echo the exact framing of the right-wing opponents of free speech on this campus? Now, Chancellor Sarsour's statement did not go unnoticed by a very large number of UMass faculty, over 130, in fact, of whom, in reaction, signed their own statement of support for today's event, affirming and defending the values that drew so many people to the university. Its proud history as an independent and progressive institution that affirms the right of its faculty to conduct research and teach the truth, even when it may cut against the grain of powerful and repressive forces. Palestinian students, too, responded to the silencing of their concerns by the Chancellor with their own forceful statement. And in a highly unusual move, over 40 faculty at UMass Boston wrote a pointed response to the chancellor challenging his view of the situation. The local chapter of JVP, Jewish Voice for Peace, also directly challenged the idea that criticizing Israel's action was anti-Semitic and insisted their support for Palestinian human rights was a direct reflection of their deep Jewish values. And lastly, but not least, another statement in support of academic freedom at UMass has been signed by leading international scholars, including Noam Chomsky, Angela Davis, who very much wanted to be here today but could not come, Rashid Khalidi, and Robin Kelly, among many, many others. And just today, the faculty union here, the MSP, the Massachusetts Society of Professors, just released a really powerful statement supporting this event and why it was so important for academic freedom. This solidarity of people, both local and international, in support of this event, and the type of engaged scholarship that has always been valued at UMass has been truly heartening. And I feel actually truly proud and honored to be part of this incredible intellectual community. Before we proceed to the next speaker, I just want to take a moment to recognize and honor, can we get the next slide? I just want to take a moment to recognize and honor the loss of one of our most valued and cherished colleagues this year. Just 3 days after the last event in May, Dan Clawson of the Sociology Department unexpectedly passed away. Dan was a model of an engaged scholar, a leading researcher in the area of organized labor, of higher education and inequality, who was also one of the most committed activists for social justice that one could imagine. He was also one of the most honorable and decent people I've ever met, as well as being one of the smartest and insightful political strategists around. When the opposition to the last event in May started, Dan actually was the first person I sought out for advice about how to respond. His family and his friends miss him dearly, and his colleagues and the institution will also miss him. He was here for 40 years. I cannot imagine a UMass without him. Now, Dan was a great believer in the power of collective action. So to honor him, I'd like to do something together, a solidarity clap. And I'll demonstrate. We start off clapping slowly, and then we gradually get faster. So for Dan. I think Dan would have been very happy at the event taking place today. Before we get started, I'd also like to acknowledge that today's event has been made possible because of the generous support of the Martin Broad Fund. Our first speaker, I'm going to introduce him now, our first speaker is Stellan Vinthagen, who is the endowed chair in the study of nonviolent direct action and civil resistance in the Department of Sociology at UMass. Actually, I just find it amazing that we have a chair dedicated to resistance studies at UMass that shows something about what we are as a university. Stellan has been engaged in the Palestinian liberation struggle for many years, both as a scholar and an activist. His latest book on everyday resistance focuses specifically on Palestine. And he is also currently teaching a class on the resistance studies, on resistance strategies used by people in 6 different places around the world, including Palestine. He has trained both Palestinian and Israeli activists in civil disobedience and was one of the organizers of the Freedom Flotilla to Gaza. an international fleet of boats that attempted to break Israel's illegal blockade of Gaza. As a result of his activism, he has been deported from Israel. And he told me he has spent so far over a year in jail as a result of his civil disobedience actions. Stellan Vindhagen is the director of the Resistance Studies Initiative here at UMass, a co-organizer of this evening's panel. Please welcome Stellan Vindhagen.
Many people and groups have criticized us for organizing this panel, arguing that BDS and Palestinian resistance are not issues that belong at university. I'll say some words explaining why they're wrong, why in fact BDS and Palestine is at the heart of academic freedom, free speech on our campus, and at the core of resistance studies. I'm a professor of sociology and the inaugural endowed chair in the study of nonviolent direct action and civil resistance. UMass is the only university in the world that have created a position dedicated to resistance studies. At the Resistance Studies Initiative, we have so far worked together with experienced activists whom we refer to as the professors of the street on several projects. These include supporting Black liberation movements, Native American resistance, and intersectional resistance alliances with Muslims, queer, working class, and other marginalized identities. And currently, we are working with activists living under military occupation in different contexts. For example, Western Sahara, Kurdistan, Kashmir, Tibet, and West Papua, to develop resistance strategies. Why should Palestine be an exception to the work we're doing in resistance studies? Free speech at the university on strategies and tactics of resistance is at the heart of resistance studies. Without it, this field of study cannot exist. Academic freedom applies also to critique of the Israeli occupation, and therefore also to discussions on resistance to the Israeli occupation. Palestine is not a personal political agenda. It's integral to academic debates and reflections about injustice, domination, and liberation. Fundamentally, in the struggle for academic freedom at UMass, it is absolutely key to defend the space to talk about BDS and protecting the freedom to also advocate for it. In my own work for over a decade, I have been a public endorser of the call coming from the Palestinian civil society for boycott strategies. At the same time, I am the editor of the Journal of Resistance Studies, which recently published arguably the most critical analysis of the BDS movement to this date. I value this critique, since it is a critique evaluating the strategy of BDS, not an attempt to censor the discussion by accusations that brand boycott as anti-Semitism. In fact, I love critical analysis of strategies of resistance, since that is what resistance studies is all about, a search for effective methods to undermine domination. But our situation now in this country is actually one of domination, where all forms of critique of the Israeli occupation are being repressed, marginalized, and even criminalized. And if that is the situation, and if those of us who are tenured faculty are not prepared to resist this repression and take up this struggle at our own campus, then what's the point of tenure? Tenure exists exactly for the principle of academic freedom, and that is what this panel is all about. As such, it is with pride we welcome this distinguished panel to the heart of UMass-Amherst. You and your speech are essential for academic freedom. Welcome. Let it begin. Before we get started today, we have a special video message from Roger Waters, co-founder of Pink Floyd. Roger has played a central role in some of the most iconic popular music in rock history, with his music serving as the soundtrack of many people's lives. But even more impressive than his musical accomplishments has been the way he has used his high profile and platform to tirelessly advocate for the rights of vulnerable people everywhere. He has been a loud and vocal proponent of the BDS campaign. Here is Roger with a special video for us this evening.
So here we are, November 12th already. You are all gathered there at UMass at Amherst for another pro-BDS meeting and discussion of open-minded people about this important issue. I did one of these panels last year, so I know what it's like. I want to say hello to Sut first and to anybody there from JVP or from Students for Justice in Palestine. Welcome. It's super important that this is going ahead. Hopefully it will be attacked by the Israeli lobby like it was last time, because that gives us the opportunity to appear before a judge in a court of law and to reiterate yet again how important the First Amendment to the Constitution is, and that freedom of speech is desperately important to a healthy society. And so voices like ours in the BDS movement should not be shut down anywhere, but particularly on college campuses. College campuses should be places where an open debate can occur about any issue, particularly issues that concern human rights, as does this meeting that you're having tonight. So I applaud you for doing it again. I'm sure it'll be instructive and informative and a great success. The Palestinians obviously are still in an extraordinarily difficult predicament. The BDS movement is growing, and it's growing more powerful, and it's beginning to frighten those who support the racist apartheid government of Israel in its settler colonialist occupation of Palestinian lands in the West Bank and its siege of Gaza. So all BDS is trying to do is to encourage the idea that equal human rights are necessary, particularly in the wake of 1948 and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights by the United Nations, for all peoples, irrespective of their ethnicity or religion or nationality. So that means that the indigenous people of Palestine who are not Jewish should have the same basic civil and human rights as either indigenous people or people who live now in Palestine who are Jewish. It's very, very cut and dried and simple. That is what we're working towards. That's what you're working towards there tonight. So I'm with you in spirit. My heart is with you. Have a great night. That's all I have to say. BDS.
Thank you. Just a word about the format of the event. This is all the preliminaries. We're getting onto the real event now. Just a word about the format of the event. In a moment, I'm going to introduce our moderator, who will then introduce our amazing panelists. They'll each speak for about 10 to 15 minutes. After everyone is finished, we'll then have a discussion among the speakers. We'll also take written questions from the audience. There are index cards available if you would like to ask a question. So I'd like to introduce now our amazing moderator for the evening, Linda Sarsour. Linda was a co-founder of the Women's March, and she is executive director of Empower Change, the largest Muslim-led social and racial justice organization in the United States. She has been involved in campaigns addressing police surveillance of Muslim communities, of police brutality, of immigration policy, and mass incarceration. She was also has organized Black Lives Matter demonstrations, and as I'm sure some of you know, she was the lead plaintiff in a suit challenging the legality of the Trump travel ban. In her own words, quote, "She is every Islamophobe's worst nightmare." Please welcome Linda Sarsour.
What up, UMass Amherst? So I was just here, as you know, a few months ago. And I thought I would never get invited back, but here I am. I am again deeply honored and humbled to be here, and I thank MEF and Sut, who's always getting me into all kinds of trouble, but as he said, he doesn't have to do much because I'm always in trouble all on my own, by myself. I don't need anybody else to get me in trouble. But I'm happy to be back, and I'm happy to be back with this absolute rock star panel. I mean, the last time it was rock star, and I was like, Soot is not gonna be able to do better than this. And then he just ups me one every time. So just wanted to give you a couple of updates about me since the last time that you saw me. I'm still as unapologetically Palestinian American as I was when I was back here in May. I am still unapologetically Muslim American and always unapologetically from Brooklyn, New York. I mean, lots of things have happened in the last few months. Lots of great things have happened, and that's really important about the conversation that we're about to have, because oftentimes we come to these events to share with everyone all the bad things and all the things that opposition is doing, and they are doing, and they're pretty powerful people. But I always realize that we're also really powerful too. And as much as opposition tries to criminalize us and tries to vilify us and tries to knock us down, we just keep getting up. And every time we get up, we're taller than we were when we were knocked down the first time. And so for me, I am always deeply grateful for the communities that I'm a part of, the solidarity movements that I'm a part of, for the wonderful groups even here at UMass who have supported us, the wonderful and bold and courageous faculty, the groups like JVP Western Mass and the SJP chapter here on this campus and all their friends and colleagues. Listen, we are in these really interesting times, and I actually, with all that we see and all the negativity that we see around us, I'm actually grateful to be alive, to witness the type of history that we are all witnessing that is happening right now. Sometimes we gotta wait decades later to look back at the moment and realize that we are making history, that we are part of history, that history is happening, but you are living it. We are living it. I am living it. And I'm so proud to be alive and witness it with all of you. Since the last time you saw me, I've been named a 2020 Roddenberry Fellow. I actually, this is self-promotion and I have to do it because my publisher makes me do these things. I wrote a book. Yeah, they're not gonna be really happy about my book that's coming out. But anyway, I have a book that's coming out in March 2020. I would love for you to support me. It's one of the first times you see, you know, Palestinian American Muslim woman in hijab that's super spicy, that has been picked up by a major publisher. So my book is called We Are Not Here to Be Bystanders. This is my message to everyone. It's in every cause, in every issue that I work on immigrant rights, on issues around Palestine, around being in solidarity with revolutions around the world, saying that Black lives matter, or saying that immigrants deserve to be treated with dignity and respect, and we all deserve to be in spaces where we feel safe and can be who we are. It all goes back to one thing that I believe, We are not here to be bystanders. We are not here to be bystanders to injustice, whether that's here in the streets of Massachusetts, or it's in Brooklyn, New York, or in Oakland, or in Bolivia, or in Chile, or in Palestine, or in any part of the world. We are not here to be bystanders. And just to share with you, you know, obviously, I guess MEF is nonpartisan, I don't even know, but I think they are. So I'm gonna say that as a disclaimer before they get in trouble. But I'm also a national surrogate for Bernie Sanders, and this is why this is important. And there, trust me, I got a point. You know, while we hear all of this and you'll hear the opposition, the criminalization of dissent and the ways in which those who stand up against the state of Israel and the human rights violations against the Palestinian people and the way that right-wing Zionist lobby groups are lobbying against the rights of Palestinians and against the rights of Americans to engage in free speech, all of that is happening. But we also gotta talk about what else is happening. Voices for the self-determination of the Palestinian people is getting louder. And it's getting louder in places that you wouldn't presume for it to get louder. And that is at the highest echelons of the Democratic Party. When I hear a Jewish candidate for president, one of the greatest political leaders that this country has ever seen, say that the fight against anti-Semitism is also the fight for Palestinian freedom. That happened here in your lifetime and in my lifetime. When we are hearing presidential candidates be cornered into saying that we must end the military occupation of the Palestinian people, when presidential candidates are being asked whether or not they would leverage U.S. aid to Israel to pressure them to stop the human rights violations on the Palestinian people, that's been a long time coming, sisters and brothers, and that is because of you and your voices and your work and the political power that our movements are building together, not just those who support Palestine, but all movements. The intersectional movement that exists today is making history, not only for the people of Palestine, but for all of us here. And I'm so grateful to, again, be alive and be here with all of you. Now, it might get really hard, and I get it. I mean, I was telling folks before, when I wake up in the morning and I breathe, I'm controversial. I don't even have to say anything. My life is hard when I wake up, but it's worth it. Worth it. It's worth it, and I'm going to be who I am, and I hope that you too will stand in your convictions and your principles and know that it may be hard today, but one day you will look back and say, I was so proud to be on the right side of history. Once you see the groups of folks, those who've spoken before me and those who will speak tonight, and the many supporters of the groups like MEF and the work that they're trying to do, you really gotta ask yourself a question. Whose team do you wanna be on? I wanna be on the team with Dr. Cornel West. I wanna be on the team with Soot Jolly. I wanna be on the team with Shaun King. I wanna be on the team with Mark Lamont Hill and Dave Zirin and Roger Waters and Angela Davis. That's the team that I wanna be on. And if you find yourself on the opposite side of that team, got a lot of questions to ask yourself, I'm just saying. So I'm gonna start with someone who is really why we're even having this conversation here today. And many of you know him, and it is absolutely disgraceful that our country is so scared of people who speak truth to power that this brilliant man has been banned from entering our country. And one day we will have a new president. And he will also be making history, by the way, because our new president will be the first Jewish American president that this country has ever seen. And then Mr. Omar Barghouti will be welcomed into these United States of America with open arms. Omar Barghouti is a founding committee member of the Palestinian Campaign for the Academic and Cultural Boycott of Israel. He's also a co-founder of the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions Movement. He has received the Gandhi Peace Award in 2017. He's probably one of the most peaceful men you've ever met in your life, contrary to everybody else and the opposition. But I'm very proud to be on the stage here, and still my heart is heavy to know that he couldn't be here in person with all of us to share this moment but I would love to give him the opportunity to share his wise words with us before we start the rest of this panel. Thank you, UMass Amherst, for having me here again, and I hope to be back.
Greetings from Palestine. I hope everyone can hear me. This last April, the Trump administration banned me from entering the US, as was mentioned, without providing a reason. Given my regular travel to the US for many years, this ban seems to be an ideologically and politically motivated measure that fits in with Israel's escalating repression against human rights defenders. Israel's far-right regime is not merely continuing its decades-old military occupation, settler colonialism, apartheid, and ethnic cleansing against Palestinians. It's increasingly outsourcing its anti-democratic tactics to the US. They've tried to silence my voice, but here I am. Their McCarthyite repression has failed. As Israel becomes a role model for far-right, xenophobic, or authoritarian leaders across the world, from Trump and Salvini to Orban, and from Bolsonaro and Modi to Mohammed bin Salman, the BDS movement for Palestinian rights has become a significant partner in a growing international progressive wave, fighting for global justice against the forces of fascism, xenophobia, and savage neoliberalism. Gaza is under attack again today. But even before the horror of Israel's full-blown bombing, from the start of the Great March of Return in 2018 to end Israel's brutal siege and assert the right of return for Palestinian refugees, Israeli army snipers have implemented what Human Rights Watch calls a premeditated shoot to kill or maim policy, slaughtering dozens and injuring thousands of peaceful Palestinians, including children, medics, journalists, and people with disabilities. UN investigators have recently concluded that Israel's acts in Gaza, quote, may constitute war crimes or crimes against humanity, unquote. Israel's 12-year-old siege of Gaza has in fact included counting the per capita calories that are allowed in to keep the 2 million Palestinians there on the brink of starvation, as was admitted by Israeli officials. It has reduced Gaza into not just a prison camp, as former British Prime Minister David Cameron once described it, but into an unlivable territory by 2020 that's around the corner, according to the United Nations. In parallel to its televised rolling massacre in Gaza, Israel's land-grabbing construction of illegal settlements and its gradual ethnic cleansing, especially in occupied Jerusalem, the Jordan Valley, and the Naqab, are accelerating. Its relentless home demolitions, arrest and torture of children, and apartheid walls are designed to make our lives so bitter that we would transfer ourselves, as one honest Israeli minister once admitted. South Africa's Speaker of Parliament, Ms. Baleka Mbete, said, quote, apartheid in South Africa was a picnic compared to what we have seen in the occupied Palestinian territories, end quote. This is what the ongoing Nakba looks like in 2019. With the unparalleled support for its fanatic policies by the Trump administration and the shameful complicity of the EU, Israel has become so drunk with impunity and colonial arrogance that it is dropping its thin, worn-out mask of democracy. It is shedding the veneer of accepting even a Palestinian Bantustan and cheering the Trump era of global bullying as a rare opportunity to bury for good the Palestinian right to self-determination. Yet, we're not asking for charity. We're asking for responsibility, accountability, and solidarity. Solidarity levels the playing fields with the colonizers and gives us hope, which is resilient and contagious. This is precisely why Israel is desperately trying to suppress the nonviolent BDS movement for Palestinian rights. as a key part of Palestinian popular nonviolent resistance and the most effective and hopeful form of international solidarity with our struggle for emancipation. Launched in 2005 by the broadest coalition in Palestinian society, BDS calls for three rights: ending Israel's 1967 occupation, ending its institutionalized system of racial segregation and discrimination, which meets the UN definition of apartheid, and upholding the right of Palestinian refugees to return to their homeland. BDS is deeply rooted in decades of Palestinian popular resistance to settler colonialism, and it's inspired and strongly influenced by the South African anti-apartheid movement and the US civil rights movement. Americans have a long and honorable history of using boycotts for social, political, and economic justice causes against the Montgomery Buses Company, California grape growers, the states of North Carolina and Arizona over anti-LGBT and anti-immigrant laws, respectively, and now against Trump's racist agenda. Similarly, Palestinians seek to use peaceful economic and cultural leverage to achieve our liberation. Anchored in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, BDS has consistently and categorically opposed all forms of racism and racial discrimination, including anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, anti-Black, anti-Indigenous racism, sexism, and anti-LGBT discrimination, among others. One's identity, the movement upholds, should never diminish one's entitlement to rights. BDS targets complicity, not identity. Since there is nothing Jewish about Israel's crimes against Palestinians, there is nothing inherently anti-Jewish then about a nonviolent, morally consistent human rights struggle to end this system of oppression. As Israel shifts steadily to the far right, forging alliances with xenophobic, racist, and patently anti-Semitic forces in the US, Europe, Brazil, India, and elsewhere, and simultaneously, as the impact of BDS continues to rise, Israel's popularity is declining worldwide. In this context, US defenders of Israel's human rights violations have desperately invested massive political and financial resources in the last few years to suppress speech on Palestinian rights and demonize BDS. Through intimidation, spying, and weaponizing claims of anti-Semitism, they're trying to keep Israel, quote, on a pedestal, as Archbishop Desmond Tutu of South Africa once said, above accountability and beyond censure. At the root of the mushrooming false claims of anti-Semitism flying about is a desperate attempt by Israel and its supporters to promote a new anti-Palestinian definition of anti-Semitism that, quote, serves to shield Israel from being held accountable to universal standards of human rights and international law, as stated last year by more than 40 progressive Jewish groups worldwide led by Jewish Voice for Peace. Daniel Blattman, a prominent Israeli Holocaust expert and chief historian of the Warsaw Ghetto Museum, was even more blunt in his criticism of this new anti-Semitism definition, especially after the German parliament declared BDS to be anti-Semitic. He said, "That is how a country where anti-Semitism was a political tool that contributed to the rise of the Nazis' murderous enterprise became a country that promotes distortion of anti-Semitism as a tool to facilitate the political persecution of a nonviolent BDS movement that fights the occupation, the oppression of the Palestinians, and the war crimes Israel perpetrates in the territories," end of quote. As reported in the Israeli daily Haaretz last February, the Israeli government faced criticism for hosting the prime ministers of the Czech Republic, Slovakia, and Hungary, who the paper describes as being accused of being anti-immigrant and anti-Semitic. In response, a Likud member of parliament, Ms. Anat Berko, defended Israel's current attitude towards anti-Jewish racism, saying, and please listen carefully, she said, quote, "They might be anti-Semites, but they are on our side," end of quote. Given all this, Israel's far-right regime is evidently in no position to accuse anyone of anti-Semitism. Israel's fraudulent anti-Semitism smears against human rights defenders in the anti-racist BDS movement sound as credible as Trump's environmental protection credentials. While defending our freedom of expression and being vigilant against all forms of racism, including real anti-Jewish racism, we're intensifying our campaigns to further multiply the impact of our BDS movement. We're strengthening our principled and intersectional alliances with global movements for racial, indigenous, social, economic, gender, and climate justice. As Angela Davis always reminds us, justice is indivisible. BDS tactics have been adopted by a number of US mainline churches, student governments in tens of universities, academic associations, racial and social justice groups, and many artists. Trade unions and political parties across the world are also adopting pressure tactics against Israel. Just this few weeks ago, the UK Trade Union Congress, representing millions of working people in Britain, voted for ending military trade with Israel and to pressure corporations to end complicity in its violations, and so did the British Labour Party. In May, instead of attracting the anticipated 40 to 50,000 tourists to flood Tel Aviv, the Eurovision Song Contest attracted a mere 5,000 visitors. Over 100 LGBTQ groups in Europe and many prominent artists joined our call to boycott the contest in apartheid Tel Aviv. In response to these and thousands of other indicators of the growing impact of BDS, Israel and its far-right allies worldwide have intensified their global war on the BDS movement, including extensive propaganda, legal warfare, and espionage. Israel has dedicated an anti-BDS government ministry, a whole ministry, to desperately establish, to fight BDS, and it desperately established a tarnishing unit, that's the official name, a tarnishing unit, to smear Palestinian, Israeli, and international human rights defenders in the BDS movement. As a co-founder of this movement, I've had my share of this smearing and repression. Israel has imposed arbitrary travel bans on me over the last 5 years, including in 2018, when I was prevented from traveling to Jordan to accompany my late mother during cancer surgery. Israel's intelligence minister threatened me in 2016 with, quote, targeted civil elimination, drawing condemnation from Amnesty. And I'm far from alone. There have always been attempts to muzzle Palestinian voices, but wherever we live, at home or in exile, Palestinians remain steadfast in our commitment to fight not only repression and McCarthyism, but also apartheid and settler colonialism. Solidarity with Palestine today means intensifying pressure to end the complicity of the US government, corporations, and institutions in enabling Israel's system of oppression. That's hardly charitable. That's a profound moral obligation to do no harm. This includes cutting the billions of dollars in military aid to Israel as part of shifting US priorities from militarization and global domination to investing in health, education, sustainable jobs, protecting the environment, and reparations for Native Americans and for Black Americans. To end Israel's regime of oppression and its anti-Palestinian authoritarian allies fear our shining a light of truth that reveals their lies. They dread our tireless quest for justice and equality. They loathe our love for freedom and our insistence on nothing less than an existence with dignity and the full menu of rights, to borrow from South African leader Desmond Tutu. United, we shall and must prevail over all oppression. Thank you.
Thank you so much to Omar Barghouti for sharing those words. He's actually going to come back a little later. We're going to actually figure out how to virtually include him in the panel. Because, you know, it's 2019. We could do anything. So now I'm really excited because I get to introduce all the fabulous people who came all the way out here to be with all of you tonight. And I'm just going to introduce them first by name, and then I'll introduce them one by one as they come up to the podium. So let's give it up to Tim Wise, Shaun King, Dima Khalidi, and Dr. Cornel West. Love to give. That's just who he is. All right, let's get the show on the road. I am so deeply honored to introduce to all of you to the podium Tim Wise, who is an American anti-racism activist, a writer, a trainer. My list of white men that I love very much is quite short, and Tim Wise makes that list. He is actually the true embodiment of allyship and using his privilege to talk about issues of race and racism. And he makes other white people feel really uncomfortable, and I enjoy watching it. So please give it up to Tim Wise.
So when you said that your list of white men that you like is really short, there's part of me that was like, is that about me being 5'8", or is that just like a really, is the list short or the guy short? All right, I mean, you know, I'm 51. I've had plenty of time to get over that shit, so I'm good. All right. Thank you so much. It is a huge honor to be here at UMass, and I want to thank all the folks that made this event possible and included me in it. I was trying to think of what my unique contribution would be this evening, and I decided, given the chancellor's comments before this event and surrounding controversy around the event, that I would take my time to speak to this matter, not merely as someone who has certainly studied the Palestine-Israel conflict and the surrounding issues, but more importantly, as a Jew who is incredibly tired of being told by other people, whether Jews and certainly when Gentiles, what anti-Semitism is, and being told, whether by Jews or other Gentiles, what self-aiding Judaism is. I have been Jewish a long ass time. I've been Jewish for 51 years. I've been white just as long. I know the Nazis don't think those two things are possible together because they are Nazis. I am not speaking to you. But I am suggesting that when you were on this earth as someone who is Jewish for 51 years, you will have experience with actual anti-Semitism, and you will know the real thing from the imposter thing. And I don't need anyone to tell me what attacks the dignity of Jewish people, as your chancellor suggested this event somehow does, right? Because my family and I have a long history of having our dignity attacked, not by Muslims, not by Palestinians, not by supporters of BDS, not by critics of Israel, but by good Christian men like Mike Pence, who insist that Jews like me will burn in a lake of fire for all eternity until we stop being Jews. That is the ultimate in anti-Semitic invective. That is the ultimate anti-Jewish bigotry. That is the ultimate in the attack on the dignity of Jewish people. And yet we got folks in this country that suck up to that nonsense, even though those folks say, oh, I love Israel, and they say, I support Zionism and I oppose BDS, but they believe that your Judaism makes your soul an empty vessel. Totes to hell with them, and to hell with anybody that throws down with them. And I would suggest to you that if you were someone who believes that Jews are inferior spiritually, your views on Israel are of no consequence to me and ought not be of any consequence to anyone who actually cares about the well-being of Jewish people anywhere on the planet, in this country or anywhere else. My great-grandfather was run out of Russia by actual anti-Semites. My father's Jewish community center was bombed by actual anti-Semites in 1957. My temple had Klansmen drive up onto the driveway when I was 13 years old, attempt to bomb it and to kill my rabbi. When I got out of college, the first thing I did was fight against David Duke, an actual Nazi, an actual anti-Semite, when he ran for the U.S. Senate and governor in Louisiana, for which we had constant death threats. Last December, my family, my children, my wife, myself were the victims of constant harassment, death threats, people coming to our house, calling our house, texting us on a regular basis, threatening to kill us all. Anti-Semites, not one of them Muslim, not one of them Palestinian, not one of them a supporter of BDS, not one of them a critic of Israel, all of them doing so in the name of good, God-fearing Christianity and white supremacy. So I do not need your chancellor, and I do not need anyone else to tell me what anti-Semitism is. Let me be very clear, if there is anything that attacks the dignity of Jews, it is the kind of thing that many of us who are Jewish were raised on that actually encouraged us to shut down this discussion before any state tried to ban it, before any campus tried to ban it. We censor ourselves. And I know this because today before I live in Nashville, so not only am I Jewish, I'm from Nashville, y'all. So the struggle is real. When you are Jewish, in Nashville, where like every four-way stop, there are three churches, right? And like the fourth corner is like a Walgreens or whatever the hell, but like, and every pastor is telling you that you're going to hell in between trying to get their record deal. So, you know, the struggle is real. But as I was leaving Nashville today, I looked up on my bookshelf in my home office and I found a book from my eighth grade Hebrew school class. Now, it's an old ass book, y'all. I was in eighth grade in 1981. In 1982, this book was written in 1980, but I brought it with me because there's a passage in here that I think symbolizes the way that we who are Jews have silenced ourselves on these important matters for too long. It isn't just about other people trying to silence criticism of Israel, trying to silence support for BDS, or trying to silence criticism of Zionism itself. It is what we do. So here's what I was taught as a child. You see, propaganda runs deep and it works. It does a number on us, and we do this to ourselves. So this book that I was asked to read when I was 13 years old, called Great Jewish Debates and Dilemmas, the subtitle is Jewish Perspectives on Moral Issues in Conflict in the 80s. All right, so dude needs an editor, first off. That's a long title. But this book, by the way, was published by the publishing arm of Reform Judaism. Right, which at that time was the most liberal, you know, sort of house of Judaism within the United States. There was Reconstructionism wasn't really a thing yet. It was sort of Reform was like, these were the liberal folks, right? And so you go through this book and there's Jewish perspectives on everything, abortion, Jewish perspectives on taxes, Jewish perspectives on immigration, Jewish perspectives on gun control. And there are all kinds of differences, right? There's like a debate that they present in here. But you get to the section on Israel, Zionism, and the Jewish people. Here's the first paragraph. You want to understand how we got to where we are right now? Here's where the first paragraph comes in. It says, if we Jews have one commitment which suffers no ambivalence, if we have one bond which unifies each and every one of us, it is our profound solidarity with the people and the state of Israel. We may differ about God and religion, politics and education, but on Israel, we are solidly united. All Jews consider themselves Zionist. And then this section goes on to say, our self-esteem, our very self-identification is tied to the fate of Israel. Diaspora survival is linked to Israel's survival in the minds of most Jews. See, when you lay it out like that, and when you say that we all agree, I remember there, I have question marks in the margin that I wrote when I was 12, y'all. And 13, I was like, what? Nobody polled me. Nobody asked me. The rabbi was coming around taking up my tzedakah money, telling me that I was giving this money so that we could plant trees in somebody else's olive grove. And I was like, why are we doing that? And they were like, you don't need to ask these questions, just read this book, see? And we're all united. But when you suggest that the debate even internally is not acceptable, when you say, is it what this is a family telling you that they will disown you if you speak out? That's what that is. That is a family telling you they will withhold love from you if you do not go, well, that is abuse. And we would see it as such in any other capacity. That attacks the dignity of Jewish people, not this forum, right? Actually, suggesting that those of us who were Jews must act as automatons devoid of ability or the need to question things. And the irony of shutting down questioning around Israel and even around Zionism itself, shutting down questioning and inquiry is like the least Jewish thing you can do, y'all. Like, the one thing I know about Judaism, I've forgotten a lot, you know, because I'm like a militant agnostic, which I know is like a contradiction in terms, because agnostics are like, you know, whatever. But one thing that I remember very well about Judaism is predicated on inquiry and questioning and debate. If you've read the Talmud is basically a bunch of rabbinical scholars got together to try to work some shit out. And they're arguing amongst themselves. And if you read it, it's completely contradictory. It is completely inconsistent because there are all these different opinions being shared. It's like if you were just taking the minutes of a meeting of a bunch of rabbinical scholars and some dude in the corner's like, how about this? And somebody else is like, that's the craziest thing I ever heard of. How about this? That's Jewish teaching and Talmudic learning. It is about inquiry. It is about question. It is about dissent. And so to suggest that questioning our particular stance vis-a-vis Israel, both the government of and Zionism as a political movement, is incredibly anti-Jewish. That assaults the dignity of Jewish people, not this forum. In fact, here's another irony. Shutting down that inquiry feeds the very stereotypes upon which anti-Semites prosper. Right? Because what are the stereotypes about our people? Right? Our stereotypes about our people are, well, you're very clannish, and you all stick together, and you only care about what's good for the Jews, and it's almost like a conspiracy to run the world. And then Jews are like, we're not going to ever allow dissent within our own community because to do so is anti-Semitic. That feeds the very notion of clannishness. It feeds the very idea that we don't care about the rights and humanity of other people. And that's not to say that we're to blame for the anti-Semitism when it happens, but when we feed into that mindset by not questioning, I can assure you, that there are actual anti-Semites, actual modern Nazis, who take great pleasure in that. And I know this because I get letters from them, messages from them, tweets from them all the time. They haven't done their homework because, like, I don't know, like, Nazis or us, research department sort of sucks, I guess. So they don't, like, use Google effectively. So they haven't actually done their homework on me, but they know I'm Jewish. They're like, what about Israel? What about, you know, the treatment of Palestinians? What about laws that provide Jews greater opportunity to buy land in Israel than those who were non-Jews? What about laws against intermarriage? What about, like I don't A, know this stuff, and B, haven't condemned it, right? And then when you do as a Jew speak out against those things, they have no response. These white supremacists, these neo-Nazis, these white nationalists, these anti-Semites are not prepared for Jews who are prepared to criticize that which we do. Right? And when we stand tall in solidarity with Palestinian people, it knocks those Nazis off balance, it knocks actual anti-Semites off balance, and it proves that we are not of one mind, except insofar as we believe in justice and will damn sure fight for it. That is the only thing that we have to insist upon. One last thing. If anything attacks the principles of Jewish dignity, I'm going to suggest, and I've felt this way for a long time, and I am perfectly willing to debate the subject. That's the point, right? Debate and inquiry. If you want to argue against BDS, argue against BDS. If you want to argue in favor of Zionism, argue in favor of Zionism. If you want to argue in favor of the Netanyahu government, good luck with that, but, you know, do your thing, right? Feel free to do whatever it is you want to do, but argue the point rather than trying to shut it down. See, my argument would be that many of the founding principles upon which Israel is based, and many of the philosophical principles of Zionism itself, are things that we ought to be willing as Jews to debate and to question. And I want to encourage everyone in this room who is Jewish to be bold enough and brave enough to do it, because it was Theodor Herzl who said this. It was Theodor Herzl who said, the philosophical founder of political Zionism, It was he who said that anti-Semitism was, quote, an understandable reaction to Jewish defects. That was not David Duke who said that. That was not Adolf Hitler who said that. That was the philosophical father of modern Zionism and the Jewish state. And then if I were to ask you who said this, each country can only absorb a limited number of Jews if she doesn't want disorders in her stomach. Germany already has too many Jews. Now, you might be inclined to think that was Hitler who said that, or someone in his government who said that. I assure you it was not. It was Chaim Weizmann who said that. At the time, he was with the World Zionist Organization. He would later become the president of Israel. That is a Jew telling the rest of the world that we are a problem and that we bring hatred upon ourselves, that we will never be safe because we are hated and hunted because we deserve it. What is self-hate exactly? Is it this panel? Is it BDS? Is it criticism of Israel? Is it criticism of Zionism? Or is it the founding principles of Zionism itself? So if you want to debate the merits of these issues, by all means, feel free. But as Jews, we must be free to demand open inquiry, open debate, both for the sake of the Palestinian people and for the sake of ourselves, the future of this country when it comes to politics and the globe when it comes to politics and human rights depend on that. So as a Jew, I implore you to support not only BDS, but more importantly, at the very least, to support the debate around this. And if you want to argue the points, argue them. But to suggest that this is an anti-Semitic movement, to argue that this violates the dignity of Jews as Jews when there are actual people out there who would hunt us and hate us into oblivion is an obscenity. And I thank you all so much for having me.
Get an amen. Amen. Lord have mercy. Tim Wise came to preach tonight. Please give it up one more time for Tim. That was next up, I want to bring up a dear brother, an activist, an organizer, a writer. Someone who, if you ever hear about an injustice and you trace it back, you probably heard about it from him, using his platform to elevate some of the most horrific acts of injustice, particularly from law enforcement on Black communities across America, on our Black sisters and brothers. He also wrote a book. He's probably not going to do this, but I will. He wrote a book called Making Change, that's gonna be coming out next year after my book, so make sure you get it. Making Change by Shaun King. So I want you, UMass, to welcome our dear brother to the stage, activist, organizer, and writer, Shaun King.
Hello. So good to see each and every one of you here. I'm glad to be here. Linda and I drove up together from Brooklyn, and now I'm just hoping that it doesn't snow so we can still get home to Brooklyn later tonight. I'm honored to be here. I'm honored to be able to support the BDS movement. And in so many ways, boycotts come out of the Black struggle for civil rights, at least for me. And I want to share a story, really a my origin story as an organizer, even share some points of some mistakes that I've made as an organizer, but then share the lessons that I've learned, because I'm hoping that my contribution here tonight is for you to be able to help us organize this movement in deep ways. About 5 years ago, I was not organizing for social justice. I had been an organizer when I was an undergrad in college. I went to Morehouse College in Atlanta. I was student government president there in 1999 when the NYPD shot and killed a young brother named Amadou Diallo 41 times on the doorstep of his home. We didn't have Twitter or Facebook or Instagram. There was no YouTube. And so it was almost 10 days after Amadou had been shot and killed before the news even got to us on campus. and we organized protests and demonstrations. 7 years later, there was a young man, again in New York, named Sean Bell, who was shot 50 times just hours before he was to be married, on his wedding day. We organized and protested for Sean Bell. But 7 years after that, in 2014, I was actually working at an environmental charity called Global Green, and my family and I had moved from Atlanta to Southern California, and I was the director of communications for that charity. And many of my friends from Morehouse, who knew me really as Sean the activist, as Sean who organized against mass incarceration and police brutality, sent me a YouTube video. And at that time, it had not gone viral. We didn't know the man's name in the video. But he sent me a YouTube video via a Facebook message. And he said, Sean, there's a video that he had found. He lived in New York. He said, Sean, there's this video that I found on YouTube. It's of a middle-aged black man who is asking the police to stop harassing him. And he said, Sean, all of a sudden, a police officer comes up behind the man and begins choking him and wrestles him to the ground and continues to choke him. I hadn't clicked on the video yet. This is my friend's description. He says, Sean, you can hear the man yelling out, I can't breathe, I can't breathe. And he says, Sean, the guy dies right there on the sidewalk. And you have to go back in time 5 years, because in July of 2014, when I got that message, there had never been a viral video of police brutality. Many of us in this room have now seen dozens of such videos, but at that time, no such video had ever been shared. And I clicked on the link and I saw the man that we later came to know as Eric Garner. And it was the first time in my life that I had ever seen, not in the movies, but in real life, seen a man who was fully alive at the beginning of that video and yet be fully dead by the end of it. He died right there on that sidewalk. And I watched as officers, the whole video is about 11 minutes long and people cut it up into 15-second clips. If you've never seen the whole video, officers began poking at him like he was an animal and even thought that he was pretending as if he was asleep, they had killed him. It was literally my last day working at Global Green. That day was the day that I started trying to figure out how I could organize just my friends, just my family, my network, to try to get justice for this man. 3 weeks later, I got a text message about a teenage boy named Mike Brown who was shot and killed on a street in a town called Ferguson outside of St. Louis. And I had the thought in my mind, wow, police are out here killing people every 2 to 3 weeks. The next day we learned that a young man named John Crawford was shot and killed at a Walmart in Ohio. The day after that, we learned about a young man named Ezell Ford who was shot and killed by police in Los Angeles, all of them unarmed, nonviolent. And suddenly, we came to understand that police in this country weren't killing people every 2 to 3 weeks. It wasn't even every 2 to 3 days. The Washington Post and The Guardian built award-winning databases where we finally came to understand that American police were killing people 3 to 4 times a day. Every single day, like clockwork, sometimes as many as 10 or 11 times a day. We began organizing all over the country, in New York, in Los Angeles, in Ohio. And then that November, a 12-year-old boy named Tamir Rice was shot and killed by police in Cleveland, Ohio. I told Linda this story on the way here, and I said something to many of these families that I have since come to regret. I would sit down in living rooms and at kitchen tables with families who had experienced this police violence, having lost their most precious loved one there, their sons, their husbands, their fathers, their brothers, their sisters, their mothers. And to many of these families, closer even than we are right now, I looked many of these families in the face and said, hold on, hang in there, we're going to get justice for your family. And not a single part of me thought I was over-promising or under-delivering. I thought we would get justice for those families. And as we organized and marched and demonstrated, as we created hashtags and trending topics, marches and protests and die-ins and sit-ins, Not a single one of those families, not one. In fact, nearly 1,200 people were shot and killed by police in 2014. And not a single family, 0.00%, got justice. None of them. Undeterred, I continue to tell families that same story. Hold on. Hang in there. We're going to get justice for your family. I told that to the family of Philando Castile as I watched him shot and killed by police on Facebook Live. And somehow I had convinced myself that his case would be the case, where certainly his family would get justice, but he didn't. I spoke that to the family of Alton Sterling, who was shot and killed in Baton Rouge. I said that to the family of a man named Terrence Crutcher, who was shot and killed in Oklahoma. Until finally I realized that the people in power who had the authority to actually bring these families some semblance of justice, I came to understand that they truly, earnestly did not care what we said. They were not moved by our protests. They were not moved by our marches or demonstrations. It's not that we were wrong to march or demonstrate or protest. Of course we were right to do so. But I came to understand that they were not moved by our hashtags or trending topics or viral videos. They were not moved by the headlines. And so we formed an organization that would ultimately replace the people who made those decisions. Understanding that if we did not organize smarter, that we did not have the type of currency with the people that we needed to be able to move. And so I learned hitting the wall over and over and over again, organizing with protesters and demonstrators all over the country. I traveled to 45 states around the country, meeting and gathering with protesters, state by state, city by city, county by county. And I learned four things that we need to do to make change. As I think about us fighting back against injustice around the world, fighting back against civil rights and human rights violations, there are four things that we have to do to make change. I want to share those four things and I'll take a seat, and I hope you can duplicate them in your own way. The first thing that you need to make change is deceptive, because we often have it, and it convinces you that you're closer to change than you really are. This room has it right now. The first thing that you need to make change is you need people, and they need to be highly energized. And there's something about getting highly energized people in a room that can convince you that you are much closer to change than you really are. But having highly energized people, it's essential, but it's just the first step. And there are times where I have been in marches and protests and planning meetings and rooms like this and rallies where the energy of the people, it can cause you to think that change is a lot nearer, a lot closer than it really is. That's because you have to have the second thing. You need people and they need to be highly energized, but you need people and they need to be deeply organized. And what I think many of us have made a mistake is that we have overestimated the value of being right and being good at the expense of also organizing ourselves. Let me push that a little bit. Have integrity, be right, be on the right side of the issue, but I need us to understand that you can be right and lose over and over and over again. And what it does is it causes many of us who believe strongly that we are on the right side of this issue, often it causes us to think that we're destined to lose, that we will always lose. But I need us to understand that being right is not enough. It's never enough. Being energized is not enough. Here is evidence of this. In 2018, in the midterm elections, both Beto and Stacey Abrams and Andrew Gillum were each mentioned 300% more than their opponents on Twitter and lost. They had the people, and the people were highly energized, but tweets are not votes. Angry face emojis are not votes. Your best intentioned Instagram post is not a vote. And I'm not saying don't click the angry face emoji, don't retweet it, don't write a well-intentioned post, but it's not a vote. We are often highly energized, but hardly organized. Right? Now, for many people, the answer is to lower our energy. I'm not saying that. I'm saying to up the quality of our organization. Here are two examples of how this group could organize, and I hope you duplicate it. And as I've started to do this, and as the teams that I'm a part of have started to do this, we have found our work to be way more effective. Here are two ways that you could organize deeply. The first is, ask yourself, who are the people that you know that could help you on this issue? Let me give you an illustration. I was organizing around a very particular law that we were trying to pass in New York, and the team that I was a part of needed to find somebody who was in a personal relationship with a particular politician. We needed a son or a daughter. We needed somebody that was close to this politician that we could meet with, that could give us a personal introduction to this person. And we searched and searched and could not find it. 2 weeks after the deadline passed and we failed to pass this law, we learned that that politician's godson was on our email list. He just didn't know we were looking for him. Sometimes you have to ask the people in the room, in your group, on your list, who are the 5 people, who are the 10 people that you know that could help us in this? That is to say, build your network deeper. And sometimes there are people in the room who have the relationship that you need, they just didn't know that you needed it. Here's another deeper form of organization. Find the skills of the people in the room. To me, the most underused asset in all of our movements for change are the human resources and skills of the people. But what I find is, as we collect email addresses and phone numbers for people, we often don't actually ask them, what are you good at? What skill do you have? What passion do you have that you could use? I'm a part of a team now that only has about 2 staff members, but we have about 200 highly skilled part-time and full-time volunteers that make our work so much more effective just because we took the time to find the skills in the room. You need energized people, you need organized people. And here's what I see happening across the country, and Linda's right, there's a lot of good news to share about the growth of this movement. Here's what I see happening. You need energized people and organized people. You need sophisticated plans that are as complex as the problem you're trying to solve. What I often find is when you are energized and organized, all of a sudden you begin moving in the right direction, but I have often seen energized, organized people confront a highly complex problem with a plan that you could write on the back of a napkin, and the size and force of that problem overwhelms the simplicity of their plan. I started asking activists and organizers around the country, not in a pandering or condescending way, I started asking them to share with me their plan. And I talk about this in my book. And I started noticing a trend right away as I asked organizers, show me your plan. I want to earnestly see it and understand it. What organizers would often do is repeat to me in beautiful, meticulous, expert-level detail the problem. And they had very subtly confused an expert level understanding of the problem, which is great and necessary, with the plan. And often because we are close to the pain, and many of you in the room feel this problem, it is your problem. When you are close to the problem, you think about it, you consider it. Your people are experiencing it. But understanding the problem is not the plan. And often we go to battle, energized and organized, with plans that will never be able to confront the problem we're up against. And I need every one of us in the room to check ourselves and ask ourselves, is our plan as sophisticated as the problem we're trying to solve? And as we begin to build out the quality of our plans with energized and organized people, we will begin to see movement. And then I'll say the last thing unapologetically, and it's part of my role as an organizer. If you are energized, organized, and have sophisticated plans, you will see some change. But if you do not fund them, if you do not provide them with the resources that are necessary, they will not be able to grow to scale. Now, raise your hand if you're a college student in the room. So I'm sure if you opened up the bank app on your phone, there's not a whole lot of resources in there to share. But if we're not each, hear me, chipping in a little bit, if you're not budgeting change, if social change is not a part of your weekly and monthly budget, hear me. I need you to understand that there are organizations, there's a conservative organization in this country that is energized, organized with sophisticated plans, that is very well funded. It's called the NRA. Last year was their worst year financially in 10 years. Well, hold on. And they raised $330 million on a down year. And here's what I understand. They are not an organization for change. They're an organization that blocks change. And there are many organizations right now that are aiming to block the change of the people in this room. They don't have the energy we have. They may not even have the organization we have, but their plans are often more complex, and here's where they often win. They often outfund our work, sometimes 10 to 1, 20 to 1. And I need us to understand that as we invest our energy and resources into organizing the movement to boycott, to divest, to force sanctions upon people who have human rights violations, it will amplify their effectiveness. Do you understand what I'm saying? You need to be energized, organized, with sophisticated plans, and we have to find ways to fund them. Thank you so much.
Give it up one more time for Shaun King. As you probably saw, as a very seasoned organizer, I was taking notes too. Next up, I want to introduce to the stage a very brilliant and powerful woman. One of the reasons many of our student groups, particularly groups on campuses that support Palestinian rights, professors, activists, and speakers like ourselves, feel really bold, because I'm like, when we go down, Dima's gonna come figure out how to represent us. So please welcome to the stage Dima Khalidi, who's the co-founder and director of Palestine Legal. She is a brilliant attorney. She used to work at the Center for Constitutional Rights, and every day she wakes up to defend our rights to stand up in these college campuses and speak truth to power in solidarity with the Palestinian people.
Good evening. It really is amazing to be here, and damn, look at my co-panelists over there. This is such a courageous and committed, and they are just unwavering justice warriors, and it is so humbling to be among them and among all of you today. Thank you so much, MEF, SUT, for making this happen again. And I obviously, people care about this. This auditorium is full, there is energy, and hopefully we'll go home organized, more organized and with better plans. What I wanna do is give a little bit of a background to this conversation to show not only how widespread the attacks on the Palestine movement are, but also to show how they fit into a wider story of growing attacks on all of our rights to organize and to dissent. I just want to start with a story of a recent incident that we at Palestine Legal have been dealing with. A young Palestinian-American student at the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, down in southern Illinois, recently gave a presentation as part of her role as a multicultural advocate in a program that was intended to, you know, give diverse perspectives about social justice issues. And her presentation was about Palestine, and specifically about Gaza's Great March of Return. And it highlighted 70 years of Palestinian resistance. So it was gave a history of the Palestinian struggle, of human rights abuses against Palestinians. It very carefully defined what anti-Semitism was, what anti-Zionism was. It defined all of the terms that she was using, including apartheid. And it painted a picture of what life was like for Palestinians in Gaza. A few housing staff at the university saw this, and within days there was school-wide upheaval. A resident assistant filed a complaint about the presentation, and the chancellor, this might sound familiar, sent a school-wide email that condemned the presentation as anti-Semitic. Now, a couple days earlier, swastikas had been found in dorms. So the email, in one line, condemned those and said that the school was investigating it. And in several paragraphs after that, went on and on about this presentation and how it offended people and how the university didn't tolerate anti-Semitism and all of the remedies that it would take in response. Trainings, investigations, rethinking this whole multicultural advocate program. Pro-Israel groups complained about it. A right group called Stand With Us said that the swastikas found on campus, along with several other attacks on Jewish symbols like mezuzahs on doors, paled in comparison to the presentation. The swastikas paled in comparison to a Palestinian-American student's presentation about her people's oppression. And Stand With Us, along with other pro-Israel groups, encouraged the university to adopt this redefinition of anti-Semitism that Omar referenced, basically labeling any criticism of Israel as anti-Semitic. Now, this is not criminalization, but it is the precursor. This kind of condemnation by public officials as something that's inherently morally reprehensible or bad is what's needed in order for the next step of criminalization to happen, of punishment, of censorship. This is the kind of attack we see every day at Palestine Legal, of course. It's the targeting of Palestinians and their allies who are speaking the truth about what's happening on the ground what has happened to them and their families, about Palestinians' lived realities of military occupation and second-class citizenship and apartheid-like conditions, about their dispossession, about being strangers in their own land and being criminalized for resisting it. We're distracted from even talking about these issues, about these realities and the truths that we know as Palestinians. Because every time we speak up, we have to respond to these accusations that our real motivation is that we're anti-Jewish. Not that we care about Palestinians or their rights, or anybody else's for that matter. And that's the point. It's to silence our ability to talk for ourselves, to tell our own stories. We're distracted, we're intimidated, we're made examples of. We're exhausted, our resources are exhausted, and we have to worry more about what we say, about how what we say affects our oppressors, than about what's happening in Palestine. I want to give a little bit of context about why this is happening and how. These attacks on the Palestinian rights movement are not happening in a vacuum, and I think the intro gave a little picture of this already. But these are part of a concerted, widespread effort to undermine and destroy this movement. Since 2014, Palestine Legal has responded to about 1,500 incidents of suppression. And that's just a fraction of what many of you have probably experienced when you speak out. These incidents have included lawsuits, like against the American Studies Association for passing a resolution endorsing an academic boycott, like against Professor Rabab Abdel Hadi, who, because of her strong voice and her scholarship on Palestine, has been relentlessly attacked. And she went through years defending a lawsuit. These kinds of things drain us. They use our resources, and they distract us from the real work. They've included professors getting fired for, like Steven Salaita did at University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, for tweeting about the massacre of kids in Gaza in 2014. They include students being investigated and punished for protesting and doing, you know, mock checkpoints on their campuses to show their peers what it's like to live under a military occupation. They've included public institutions like libraries and universities and museums canceling events because there were complaints that it would be too biased or too offensive. And they've included widespread surveillance of activists, like Omar mentioned. Not only does Canary Mission profile thousands of students and professors, but we have, at the recent NSJP conference, National for Students for Justice in Palestine, there were people taking pictures of everybody going in and out and posting on the internet horrible things about them, and resulting in more attacks and death threats and rape threats. This is what it means to speak out for Palestinian rights today. You are vulnerable to this kind of relentless harassment, and it's often anonymous. And we see, of course, FBI agents knocking on doors and asking people about their activism. And of course, on top of all of these various tactics that are being used, we have a wide-ranging legislative assault happening. 27 states now have laws that punish in one way or another boycotts for Palestinian rights. Of course, we know Massachusetts legislators are trying for the third time to introduce an anti-boycott bill. And we're also expecting a new wave of legislation that tries to redefine anti-Semitism. For use in investigations of campus activists that allege anti-Semitic discrimination. All of this legislation has real consequences for people. Anti-boycott laws have resulted in the loss of jobs and opportunities for people like Bahia Amawi, the Palestinian American speech pathologist in Texas, who, when she went to sign a contract for maybe the ninth year, all of a sudden she saw a certification. She had to sign something that said, I won't boycott Israel. I don't and I won't boycott Israel, in order to have this job. And she refused. And she sued. And she's winning. And that's fantastic. We're seeing courts striking down these laws slowly, but these battles take forever. And we cannot rely on the courts. And beyond these real consequences, the chilling effect is enormous. And that's what's really the intent that is really behind the laws. It's to use them to shut us up, to confuse us. Is this criminal? Am I allowed to boycott? People come to us with these questions every day. What does it mean that our legislators are saying that boycotts are this and boycotts are that? So it's important to understand that all of these efforts are being encouraged, they're being facilitated, they're being funded with tens and tens and tens of millions of dollars, not just by Israel, but by dozens of Israel advocacy groups here. And we have armies ready to attack anyone who utters the word Palestine or BDS. The other context that's important is that this is a global problem. And I think Omar mentioned that. The kind of censorship we're seeing in Germany after its parliament passed a resolution saying that BDS is anti-Semitic. Artists are being denied prizes. Talib Kweli was disinvited from a music festival because he refused to renounce BDS. In France, activists are being criminally prosecuted for engaging in BDS campaigns. What's happening in France and Germany and other countries in Europe is really the logical and the intended conclusion of what Israel and its allies are working towards here as well. Government sanctions censorship and punishment of Palestinian rights advocacy. We have to understand that that is the aim. They don't want us to talk. They don't want us to organize. They don't want us to expose what's happening. And the other piece of context that is really critical is that we're not just talking about anti-boycott laws. We're talking about an enormous attack on our right to dissent across the board. We've seen 16 states that have enacted anti-protest legislation. Many of these laws are imposing actual criminal penalties and fines on protesters. And these movements that are being attacked are, you know, indigenous rights movements, climate justice movements, racial justice movements. These include so-called critical infrastructure bills that criminalize indigenous and environmental activists' resistance to pipelines and the protection of water and indigenous land and resources, so-called free speech laws that are weaponizing the First Amendment to protect far-right speakers from student protests on campuses. Not exactly what I think the First Amendment was intended to do, which was to protect us from the government's censorship, not from our own protests. And of course, we see the FBI labeling the Black Lives Matter movement and the movement for Black Lives, Black Identity Extremists. So in this era, with these right-wing agendas as ascendant, our rights to dissent, to protest, to collectively rise up against all of these injustices are being sacrificed to protect the status quo of white supremacy and corporate power. This is what we're up against. This attack is also not happening outside of history. And that's really important to remember as well. In our history, it's a matter of course that dissenters and popular or unpopular social justice movements have been targeted by the government. From communists in the 40s and 50s with McCarthyite witch hunts, to the civil rights and black power movements of the 60s and 70s and the anti-war movement, people calling for revolutionary, radical change have been mercilessly attacked, assassinated, surveilled, infiltrated, as was the American Indian movement and the Chicano power movement. This is not an anomaly, let's be clear. The difference with the Palestinian rights movement here is that it's not the US government that's been leading the crusade. It's been private pro-Israel groups pressuring the US government, and they've failed a lot, they actually have. But with an administration now that is so fundamentally anti-Palestinian, with the staunchest Zionists in the highest of positions, and a Christian Zionist base with enormous influence, we're seeing the state increasingly take up this suppression, heeding the calls through legislation, through surveillance, through investigations into Palestine advocacy. And it's part and parcel of a widespread attack on the left, where the real and the deadly anti-Semitism of the far-right white nationalist movements is given a pass. And the human rights advocacy of the left is posited as the biggest threat to Jewish communities. This is the narrative that we're hearing. The swastikas pale in comparison to an educational presentation about Palestine. I want to also be clear that all of this is happening because we are winning. We're winning. And we're winning because we're organizing at the grassroots, and we're organizing across movements. And the youth are leading the way, SJP. And as Omar said, the Palestinian call for BDS has been taken up by churches and unions and student governments and athletes and authors and singers. Now, as an example, the University of Illinois students, they weren't having it. They weren't having the mass mail. They weren't having this complete conflation of anti-Semitism and anti-Zionism. They weren't having the university ignoring the real racism happening on campuses. And they've been organizing for weeks. SJP made a list of demands calling for the chancellor to apologize, to issue a new statement clearly distinguishing between anti-Zionism and anti-Semitism, to institute trainings not just about anti-Semitism, but about anti-black racism and queerphobia and Islamophobia, as well as anti-Semitism. And 15 other student groups, from the Black United Front to Jewish Voice for Peace to environmental justice groups to Latinx groups to socialist and Arab and Muslim groups, signed on to these demands. And hundreds of students attended teach-ins and protests, and they threatened to do a sit-in at the chancellor's office. And then they got a resolution passed in the student government endorsing their demands and demanding that the university issue an apology. This is the kind of organizing that it takes. This shows how students are leading the way with their unapologetic and their bold demands. And they're able to do this because they've been organizing for years. with other students on other social justice issues, educating and mobilizing each other. This didn't happen overnight. These students have been at college learning and organizing. That's what it's for. And it's clear that this intersectional work and the solidarity that has grown between movements is the biggest threat. Israeli officials have said point blank that the major problem with Israel is the young generation of the black community. Clearly, the immense backlash that black intellectuals and activists who speak out for Palestinian rights, from Mark Lamont Hill to Angela Davis to Michelle Alexander, it's a result of how much weight such solidarity holds, how much it clarifies the answer if you believe in equality and justice and human dignity for all. The truth is that there's no BDS or terrorist boogeyman whose demise will bring the rest of the movement crashing down. This is a decentralized, a grassroots, an intersectional movement that understands that Palestinian freedom is bound up with the freedom of oppressed and marginalized people everywhere. This is why it's possible for Massachusetts to again defeat this anti-boycott legislation. A 100 grassroots activist groups joined the last two times and defeated it. And we can win these fights, even in these forums where we don't historically have power. The last point I want to make is that we are winning, but as Shaun alluded to, we're outnumbered and we're definitely out-resourced. And perhaps we need better plans as well. And things are really likely to get worse for all of us. So it's imperative that we continue to organize, to speak out, to defy these odds. Organizations like ours, PALLEGAL, is here to help and to tackle the legal threats against this movement, to protect folks from the attacks. But in order for us to see not only Palestinian freedom, but also black and brown freedom and indigenous freedom and environmental justice, etc., we have to have each other's backs. We have to lift each other up. We have to show up. Ultimately, we have protection in our numbers. 1,600 sold out crowd, that's a big number. We have protection in our principled and unwavering commitment to freedom and justice and equality for everyone without exception. We have strength in our clear rejection of racism, xenophobia, transphobia, homophobia, anti-Semitism, Islamophobia, and the white supremacy that is fueled by all of this hatred. So if we have all in this room, if we all stand firm and stay loud and show our collective power, we can and we will win. Thank you.
Give it up for Dima Khalidi. I heard these words once. Empathy is not simply a matter of trying to imagine what others are going through, but having the will to muster enough courage to do something about it. And these words have inspired me ever since. They are the words of a brilliant scholar, a freedom fighter, a truth teller, everybody in the movement's big, big brother, the wonderful, fabulous, I can't even think of all the great words I want to say about this man, Dr. Cornel West.
Oh, what a blessing to be here, University of Massachusetts Amherst! What an honor, what a privilege. I want to begin by saluting my dear brother Jolly. Where's Dr. Jolly? Oh, what a visionary leader. Give it up for that brother. 35 years. I don't know where he is, but he's somewhere out there. He's somewhere out there. I want to salute my dear brother Omar. That was 2:30 in the morning there in the Middle East. Give it up for brother Omar. He's my dear brother. Sister Linda, Sister Dima, Brother Shaun, Brother Tim, we are here to say first and foremost that we will not cave in, we will not sell out, we will not back down. We are fundamentally committed to this, the well-being of human beings, no matter where they are, be they on the West Bank, be they in Gaza, be they, yes, in Tel Aviv. We're concerned with everybody, but we got a critique of occupation. We got a critique of any form of domination that loses sight of the humanity of others. Is that right? Is that right? And I simply come by here to say that I'm just one small voice of a great tradition of a grand people who've been terrorized for 400 years and taught the world so much about freedom. Frederick Douglass is no joke, and Harriet Tubman is no joke either. Their voices matter even here in 2019. We're here to keep their legacy alive. That's what solidarity is all about. That's what raising our voices all about. I come from a people who have been hated for 400 years and taught the world so much about love. And I'm here because I want to stay on a love train. I can play a little John Coltrane, Love Supreme for you and back up with me. A little Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. Or some Witness from Martin Luther King Jr. Or some novels called Beloved by Toni Morrison. Or the Love Soak essays of a genius from Harlem who taught at this grand institution, James Baldwin, the son of Harlem. It goes on and on and on and on. And I simply want to say, I've got four fundamental questions raised by the greatest public intellectual in the history of the American empire. His name is W.B. Du Bois. His papers deposited right here by my dear brother Herbert Abdecker. And Du Bois had four questions for any generation concerned about the quest for truth, the quest for goodness, the quest for beauty, and the struggle for freedom. How shall integrity face oppression? How do we talk about integrity in such a way that we're honest and we are willing to be self-critical? The Socratic legacy of Athens, the prophetic legacy of Jerusalem, that noble discontent, that critical discontent that sits at the very center of any conception of education. And by education, I mean what the Greeks call paideia, P-A-I-D-E-I-A. That's different than cheap schooling. That's my message to your chancellor today. That any chancellor ought to be committed to Socratic energy. Any chancellor ought to be committed to robust and uninhibited conversation. Any chancellor ought to recognize that the quest for truth, capital T, is one in which none of us possess that full truth, capital T. But I come from a people whose anthem is what? Lift every voice. Lift every voice. It doesn't say lift every echo. And we don't want echo chambers. Yes, we've got disagreements. Yes, we've got a whole host of contestations and conflicts. Our dear brother Bernie, who I did love very much, strongest position when it comes to the humanity of Palestinians and the humanity of Jews. He and I disagree on PDS. I think he's wrong. I think he thinks I'm wrong. I still love the brother. We still work together. But I'm in solidarity with the Palestinians to the degree to which when I hear their voices say, Brother West, this is our last nonviolent chance. This is the last nonviolent strategy and tactic, given the misery that we're living in, given the unbelievable oppression we're coming to terms with. Please don't allow our humanity to be rendered invisible. And I can hear Socrates saying the unexamined life is not worth living, and Malcolm X saying the examined life is painful. I can hear Amos saying, let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream. I can hear Esther saying, here I stand. I can hear Jesus and Muhammad saying together, keep track of the least of these. I don't care if they're Palestinians. I don't care if they're in Kashmir. I don't care if they're in Tibet. I don't care if they're in sub-Saharan Africa. I don't care if they're Dalits in India. I don't care if they're white poor in Africa. the question that we're wrestling with right here. What kind of human beings do you really choose to be in the short time in your trek from your mama's womb to tomb? That's a question for the students. Because every generation has to come to terms with the question that Dostoevsky raised when it was his birthday yesterday, 198 years old. Dostoevsky said, how you gonna come to terms with the massive suffering, the structures of domination, the hatred, the envy, the resentment that characterizes so much of we human primates given our history? And lo and behold, here come the forces of conformity, complacency, cowardliness. Look at line 24A of Plato's Apology, where Socrates says, the cause of my unpopularity was parhesia, P-A-R-R-H-E-S-I-A. And that means frank speech, fearless speech, unintimidated speech, free speech. Those who raise their voices in fearless speech, unintimidated speech, not in a narcissistic, self-righteous way, but concerned about others. That's why talking about love is not mamby-pamby stuff. Harry Belafonte, you understand, that wrote that wonderful foreword to my sister's book. It's a steadfast commitment to others, especially those who are like orphans, those who are like fatherless, motherless, persecuted, oppressed, hated, and despised. And one of the difficulties of this particular situation is, you got our precious Jewish brothers and sisters, hated, despised, devalued, oppressed, attacked for 2,000 years with underdog mentality, and now find themselves in a top dog status and losing sight of their own underdogs, the precious Palestinians who are just as precious as the Jewish brothers and sisters. I'm here to remind us that a Palestinian baby has exactly the same value and significance as a precious Jewish baby. And a Jewish baby has precisely the same significance and value as a Palestinian baby. So when we hear 551 Palestinian babies who have been killed, there ought to have been voices of righteous indignation put forward in every corner of the nation, every nook and cranny of the empire. And if not, that's a sign of just how spiritually empty we are, because it's a sign of our callousness toward the suffering of Palestinians. It's a sign of our indifference toward the suffering of our Palestinians. My dear brother, Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel reminds me, indifference to evil is more insidious than evil itself. And that's part of what we're wrestling with. But the chancellor talked about, we don't stay in contact with the humanity of the Israeli side. Have you looked at the history of the voices of the BDS movement? Did you hear our brother talk honestly about there's nothing Jewish about mistreating and dominating and occupying and subjugating Palestinians? That's a human choice of Jewish brothers and sisters of a certain political and ideological orientation. We got Noam Chomsky. We got a whole wave of Jewish brothers and sisters who choose to stay in contact with the humanity of Palestinian brothers and sisters. Don't put that construct up there and somehow talk about Jews as if there's some block, some homogeneous block. No, they're human beings who choose. If you are a Jewish right-wing racist, you choose to be a racist. You choose to lose sight of the humanity of Palestinians. And so it is on the underside. If we got some Palestinian brothers and sisters who are hating Jewish brothers and sisters, we call it into question. They're choosing that, but they're hating the domination. They're hating their occupation. Absolutely. And rightly so. And within the BDS movement, just like a jazz orchestra, this is no military band of unanimity. This is a heterogeneous movement of a variety of different voices. I love my dear brother Omar to death. I don't agree with everything, even though most of it I do. That's not the point. I don't agree with everything with Bernie. I don't agree with everything with my mama. And I love her and take a bullet in the heart. But I'm tilting in a certain direction. And there's no doubt that the various establishment, right wing, conservative, neoliberal, and too many of our progressive comrades don't want to raise their voices when it comes to Palestinian suffering. Why is that? We are calling you out too. You don't have to be so scared. You don't have to be so intimidated. Straighten your back up and take a stand in the name of integrity, honesty, decency, courage, the four questions Du Bois was talking about. So that when they, in fact, come to your funeral and your body's in the coffin, they're not gonna talk about your curriculum vitae. They're not gonna talk about how much money you made. They're not gonna talk about how many trophy spouses you were with. They're not gonna talk about the mansions that you inhabited. They're gonna talk about what kind of human being were you. Did you exemplify integrity, honesty, decency, and courage? Did you take a stand on behalf of those people whose precious babies and men and women are being assaulted, attacked, whose homes are being bulldozed, whose land is being taken? And let us be clear, and I'll sit down. Let us be very clear. If there were a Palestinian occupation of precious Jewish brothers and sisters, there would be a mass movement of PDS, and rightly so. I would be a part of it because I believe in the primacy of the moral and the spiritual. I'm in solidarity with human beings. I don't care what color, religion, sexual orientation, or gender. And it, given the fact that there isn't such silence given a vicious Israeli occupation of Palestinians, we not only see the double standard, we not only see the moral hypocrisy, but we also see the spiritual emptiness of a late capitalist civilization obsessed with greed and money and status and spectacle and image, making it, rather than keeping faith with something bigger than you. That's what we're wrestling with. And that's why we're getting the creeping fascism, not just in the American Empire, but in various parts of the world, in Europe, in Asia, in Africa, in Latin America, that the moral catastrophe, the spiritual catastrophe, the political dysfunctionality, the rule of big military, big money, the scapegoating of the most vulnerable, that is the makings of a fascist globe in various ways, and this is part of the struggle to say no. This is part of the struggle to say we will go down swinging in this context with our precious Palestinian brothers and sisters, but in a variety of other contexts, we're gonna hold up a bloodstained banner of integrity, honesty, decency, and courage, and yes, we're gonna fight the establishment that will tell the lies about what has been going on since 1948 and what has been going on since 1964. Why are you so afraid of the truth? Why you don't want to come to terms with what it is to be a settler colonial regime? Why is it that you don't want to come to terms with your relation with an empire? We must be concerned about our precious Jewish brothers and sisters who feel as if their backs are against the wall, who jumped out of the burning buildings of Jew-hating Europe and landed on land where somebody else was there alongside other Jews, and they had a choice. They could go with Albert Einstein. They could go with Judah Magnus and say, we will coexist. Or they could go with Jabotinsky and say, we will dominate and we will create any means in which these Palestinians are subordinated and degraded. Right now, the legacy of Jabotinsky reigns in Israel, and we have to be honest and candid about that, and we have to raise our voices. It's a beautiful movement to see so many young Jewish brothers and sisters breaking from their parents and their grandparents and say, you've been lying to me. I'm concerned about the truth. You've been telling me all this talk about the prophetic tradition, and yet when it comes to Palestinians, you want me to remain silent. Lo and behold, I've got a new vision. I've got new energy. I've got a new way of being in the world that leads toward a solidarity with all the human beings who are concerned with those Frantz Fanon called the wretched of the earth. Do we have what it takes? I don't know, but I can tell you, I'm going down swinging like Ella Fitzgerald and Muhammad Ali.
Barghouti, who's still actually with us, just to give him an opportunity to just join this conversation on this panel, I wanted to ask him to just quickly share with us what the current iteration of the BDS movement is, where are people needed in this particular moment for those who want to be a part of it or support in this moment. So if there's a particular campaign that the BDS movement is kind of focusing on right now or areas where you think people can jump in, Omar, we would love to hear what it is.
Thanks, Linda, and thanks for the wonderful panel. I'm really honored to be with you, although in cyberspace. I think there's several campaigns that one can point to. At the policy level, the most important is cutting US military aid to Israel. Now that we have Bernie Sanders and many presidential candidates in the Democratic Party calling for leveraging aid to Israel, conditioning it on respect for Palestinian rights, I think we have passed a very important threshold, and we should push further. But as I said in my talk, it has to be part of an overall change of direction in the US from ongoing, very aggressive bullying, imperialism, hegemony around the world, neoliberalism, and 1% policies to investment in health, education, and social services, climate protection, and so on. As part of that, it's important to cut military aid to Israel because it's using it to abuse us. Our oppression has made in the USA written all over it. A second very important campaign at a more grassroots, municipal level, city council level, is a campaign led by Jewish Voice for Peace with Black justice movements and others called Deadly Exchange. It's ending the joint training of Israeli and US police because they're feeding each other's racism and violence and militarism. And we see the results in Baltimore and Ferguson and Gaza and everywhere else. So that's a very important campaign. Finally, churches and some unions and some student governments are calling for divestment from specific companies involved, deeply complicit in Israel's violations of Palestinian rights, be it Caterpillar, HP, Motorola Solutions, and others. Those are very important to continue because we think that companies are listening. Some of them are already selling their business in Israel, especially their illegal business, and pulling out. So we're making it. Just to give one example, and I'll end with that, we had a seven-year campaign against Veolia, a French giant corporation. Palestinians are very patient. Yes, it took 7 years. But we had many, many supporters around the world. And after those 7 years, Veolia lost more than $20 billion, with a B, billion dollars worth of contracts and tenders. And finally, they pulled out completely from Israel. So we can do it.
I just want to be on the record, Omar, to let you know how very proud I am to be of the same lineage as you, as a Palestinian, for all your courage and for all the work that you have done. And I want to say again on the record that I am ashamed as an American that someone of your brilliant stature is not welcome in the United States of America. But we promise you that we will continue on this path, and there will be a day where I was talking to Shaun, we're going to organize a big rally at an airport to welcome you back here to share the brilliance that you've done. So we appreciate you
very much. Thank you.
So one question that I wanted to ask everybody on the stage, and it's actually a question that a lot of people ask me, and I never really know how to answer the question. There's a lot of people who will say, I agree with everything that everybody's saying. That's something that I really believe. I believe in my heart, you're logical, you make sense, and I believe this. But where do you get the courage to say these things and to stand in the convictions that you have? What was that moment for you, particularly on the issue of Palestine, where you just said one day, look, I'm just, I'm going out here and just gonna see what happens. Like, what was that? What was the thing or that moment for you?
Weigh in on that. I wish this wasn't the case for me, but it is. It's just my story. It's as I began developing meaningful friendships with Palestinian people, both here in the United States and around the world, it educated me, it tied me in an emotional way to the pain and oppression that was experienced there. And I think some of what happens is that we often operate in such bubbles and isolation. And I've told this story many times. For, I would say, the first 30 years of my life, my world was very black and white. I grew up in rural Kentucky. Then I went to college at Morehouse College, which was an all-black school for young men. Then I lived for the next 10 years in Atlanta in a community that talked very little about civil rights and human rights outside of Atlanta. And it wasn't until I started developing just deep, meaningful relationships with indigenous people that I started being educated about the problems experienced by indigenous people in this country. When I started developing, deep, like, I see you as one of the most important people in my life. I see several of my best friends are from Palestine. And in those relationships, it just builds a natural love for people, their joy and their pain. And it's part of why I try to encourage people the best they can to get outside of your racial bubble, your generational bubble, your ethnic or religious bubble. And in doing that, the people outside of my bubble have done way more for me. I have been enriched and grown as a result, way more than I've been able to reciprocate that. And so, you know, I wish that it didn't take me being in those relationships to understand, but it's what did it for me.
So for me, I told you earlier, even in Hebrew school, I had these questions that my rabbi refused to indulge, and I was sort of, always questioning this idea that a Jewish kid from Nashville, or a Jewish kid in Des Moines, or a Jewish kid in Seattle, somehow had this birthright to a land that my people hadn't been on for thousands of years, potentially, if at all, as opposed to those who had been there unbroken over a period of generations. It seemed preposterous to me. And so I always had these sort of questions that, again, we couldn't really engage. Now, having said that, though, because we who were Jewish are taught not to publicly say these things, a lot of this remained private for me. I became an activist in college, but really wasn't talking about this issue. And I was, I came of age in the 80s and like a lot of people, was involved in the anti-apartheid movement vis-a-vis South Africa. And the moment that clicked for me that I knew I had to say something more publicly about this was being in that movement. And one day, I went to Tulane in New Orleans, and one day, oh, thank you. Awesome.
There's always that one guy.
Was it New Orleans or Tulane? I think it was probably New Orleans that got the hooray there. So one day we were camped out, and we had built shanties, which was the thing we did in those days, in front of the administration building to sort of replicate the housing conditions that black South Africans were forced to live in under white minority rule. And we were in the middle of a hunger strike, like third day of the hunger strike, and I remember the rabbi at Hillel, who fashioned himself very progressive on all things except this, shocking, I know, came to me and he took me aside and he said, "I just want to thank you." And I was like, "Well, what for?" He had always been supportive of the divestment movement, to his credit, and vis-a-vis South Africa, I should specify. And he said, I want to thank you. And I said, why? He said, well, because I just really appreciate how during all of this movement, we've been at it for a couple of years and trying to get Tulane to divest from companies that were propping up white minority rule. He said, in all this time, you haven't really, you know, gotten into all of that mess about Israel's support for South Africa. And I was like, well, Rabbi, it's just sort of not pertinent to this particular iteration of the movement. We're talking about Tulane. It's not that I hadn't noticed, and it's not that I'm okay with it. And he's like, well, I just really appreciate that you haven't brought it up, because, you know, that just muddies the waters and da-da-da-da-da. And I remember going home for winter break and reading something. Are you on the bill tonight? Did somebody come to hear you? Did somebody come to hear you?
Free, free Palestine! 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 Free, free
respectfully submit that that we couldn't have paid for that to prove the point that we're trying to make about the importance of real dialogue as opposed to that, which is clearly a fascist impulse and authoritarian impulse that wants to shut down discussion and cannot engage in debate, which is ironic coming from people who usually accuse us of being the ones who want to stifle debate on campus, and then they do that. So back to the story real quick. The rabbi says, you know, I'm glad you don't bring that up. And I realized in that moment that he was asking for my silence. And he was asking for my collaboration with that silence. Okay, it's fine to talk about South African apartheid, but don't bring up our role, Tim, as Jews. And he would say things like, you know, because all the Arab states support South Africa too. That to me never made sense as an excuse, because I remembered as a time, as a child, and many of you may have this experience, playing baseball outside with a friend and breaking a window. And as I recall, when my mom got mad at me and I got in trouble, the excuse that Billy broke the window too was not accepted by my mother. As I recall, my mother said something about Billy and a bridge, and whether or not if I threw myself off of it in the manner of a damn fool, if he did that, would I follow him? You know, and so the rabbi was asking for my silence, and at that moment I realized I couldn't offer it. Wow. And that was the first time I ever wrote anything about Israel. I wrote something about, because what was ironic to me about it was four of the first prime ministers of South Africa, the heads of state in South Africa under apartheid rule post 1948, were imprisoned during World War II for collaborating with Nazis. Mm-hmm. So to me it was very ironic to say we're not going to condemn Israel for supporting a government whose first leaders were Nazi collaborators. Not only is that offensive in terms of what it means for Palestine, it's offensive to me as a Jew.
Wow.
And I was told to speak up as a Jew against injustice, against others, and against my own, and that was what did it for me.
Yeah, no, just very, very briefly, I was very briefly, I was blessed to meet my dear brother Edward Zayed 42 years ago. And he is the greatest public intellectual after the birth of W.B. Du Bois. And when you read Orientalism, you read The Question of Palestine, you read Saving Islam, you read his book on the Oslo Accords, it's as if they were written last week. Mm-hmm. It's that powerful. That his work constitutes a kind of BCAD in terms of the shift in the American discourse. Now, he didn't do it all by himself, but I was blessed to know him up until his death. We spent much time together. We had teach-ins at Columbia in the late 1970s and the early 80s. Dealing with U.S. apartheid, Junior, which is new Jim Crow, Jim Crow Junior, and South African apartheid, and vicious Israeli occupation, apartheid-like in a very, very ugly and vicious way. And he was already out there. And I remember the bodyguards, you know, right in front of his office each and every day because he was under death threats. And then, of course, sooner or later, many of us joined that club. But let us never forget Edward Said. He's one of the great ones. He's one of the great
ones.
He's one of the great ones.
Well, you'd think that as a Palestinian, it, you know, it kind of comes natural. You kind of have to one way or another. But I think that's actually not true at all. And you see a lot of Palestinians who have kept their mouths shut, who have changed their names, who don't identify as Palestinian, who you know, have just gotten by, and they understood that if they speak out on this issue, it means their careers, it means a lot of things. So I think for me, it was really the family I was raised in, and you know, being in a family of intellectuals, being in a family of people who were speaking out all the time, and you know, were facing the death threats and had bodyguards. And, you know, it was real, and it was also always understood as a sense of responsibility, mm-hmm. and having the privilege that I did, and being educated and being able to go to law school, you know, those kinds of privileges are something that I never felt I could take for granted. So it was also for me the kind of educational path that I took and the people that I was around. I always had a sense of this injustice being connected with all the others. And I actually learned so much studying the history of Black resistance and Indigenous resistance. And that actually gave me a lot of courage as well, kind of seeing that, you know, it's not just us. That has to resist. We all have to resist all of this injustice that we're facing.
Beautiful. Omar, where do you get your courage from?
Well, if I did not have the courage, I couldn't exist because I would have to live as a slave. Mm-hmm. And that's something I cannot tolerate. So to me, freedom means everything. And I couldn't imagine myself except as resisting in whatever means I can. But I certainly got a lot from my father, who was one of the founders of the PLO in 1964, and my mother and my grandmother. There were quite a few very strong women in my life, my mother, my grandmother, my aunts, who taught me a lot about resistance, about resilience, about refusing to bow to the occupation, to apartheid. And I think all of those factors have helped a lot. The second most important part that shaped my understanding of the world, actually, was by the very modest role I played in the South African anti-apartheid movement when I went to school at Columbia. I learned quite a lot from the Black leaders of that movement at Columbia. And it was like pulling nails at the time. It was not easy as people imagine it in a very romantic way. It took many, many years. And they led that struggle in a very white-dominated environment, a very elitist environment. But they pulled it through. And we did get Colombia to divest, ultimately. So that taught me a lot.
Wow. I mean, I will just share this, and it's something that I've learned from many leaders, but in particular from Dr. Cornel West, this idea of love. And he talks about love, 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 everything, love, love, love. And one time somebody asked me this question, you know, why do you do the work that you do? A lot of people say because of hope, you know, you hope, and that you can see a vision. I don't always know if I see, and I realize it wasn't hope. And I think for me, my personal courage comes from deep love. Like, I love my Palestinian children. I love my Palestinian mother and my Palestinian grandmothers and my Palestinian great-grandmothers. And I think my courage comes from this love. And if one day I don't love those people anymore, which is never gonna happen, that's when I will lose my courage. And so I want you to know, Dr. Cornel West, your particular inspiration of making us understand that we do this work from a place of love. And while everyone else is trying to label our work as divisive and comes from a place of hatred. It really does come from a place of love, and where we want everybody. I don't want something for me that I don't want somebody else to have. I don't want to take away from Jews just so the Palestinians can have. I want everybody to have liberty and freedom and justice and not only be able to survive, but to thrive. So I appreciate you. I appreciate you very much. And I wanted to actually say something really positive about the young man, Tim, that left here, unfortunately. He's actually stayed pretty quiet throughout everyone's speeches. He allowed you all to speak. And then he decided to interrupt. So I will call him a quite respectful heckler. Thank you. We have to sometimes acknowledge the good, Tim.
He has high frustration tolerance, but
sorry.
Still, nobody came to hear him, though.
Oh, no. Which is how I learned that whole chanting thing. So if you ever have organizing events and things like that happen, and not only about Palestine, but about anything around anti-immigrant, anti-LGBTQ, find a chant that you all love and agree with and everybody wants to say, and say it together and drown out hate. Because one thing that Dima did say tonight that I kind of a little bit disagree with is, I do believe that we are sometimes out-organized and sometimes out-resourced, but I do not believe that we are ever outnumbered. We are not outnumbered, and we are more than them, and I believe that. So I wanna give everybody one round to really answer this last question. We're gonna bring up some fabulous people up here to help us close out the evening tonight. But I wanted to say, I mean, a lot of people here wanna leave with something. Like, what do people leave here to do? What kind of advice do you give people in this very interesting political moment that we're in right now? And when people are telling you, be quiet, be silent, don't get involved in this issue, don't do this, don't do that, don't upset the status quo, what kind of advice do you give people when they leave here today?
So I'm just gonna give the advice, well, it's something that, again, goes back to the anti-apartheid movement that I learned that has been sustaining for me for 30 plus years since then. And it's helpful because if you're an activist on this or any issue, you face these moments of frustration and hopelessness and burnout and all of this, and you're constantly looking for that thing that gets you up the next day to fight the fight. And you know, justice and the cause isn't always enough to do that on every day, because sometimes we're weary, you know? And so when we were doing the anti-apartheid movement, like a lot of places, we didn't succeed in getting divestment. We thought we were on the brink. We, you know, Archbishop Tutu was offered an honorary degree. We got him to turn it down because we got him all the information about our investments. He said, oh my God, I had no idea. So it was this huge, you know, PR coup. We thought we were on our way to this big victory, and it didn't happen. And so we were all very frustrated, as we will all be if you fight for justice. And when we were at our most dejected, I was about to leave. This is sophomore year of college, about to leave to go home. I go to check my mailbox one last time, and there's a letter from Archbishop Tutu, who had written to me as one of the leaders of that movement, one of the founders of that organization. And it was this amazing letter. I had not had a chance to speak to the Archbishop, but it was as if he read my mind and our mind about sort of where we were with the frustration and the burnout. And of course, like an idiot, you know, I wasn't a hoarder like I should have been, and so I threw the letter away. But I memorized it, and I remember what the Archbishop told me. I will never forget it. He said, you don't do the things you are doing because others will join you in the doing of them, or because they will necessarily prove successful. You do the things you do because the things you're doing are right. And hearing that at the age of 19 or 20, whatever it was that I was, right, was the kind of thing that made me remember that justice may or may not come in our lifetimes with this or any other issue. We have a very short time on this planet. And what he was saying was sort of what Dr. West was saying. You have to make a decision what kind of human being you're going to be. And you have to make a decision to do, as James Baldwin said, earn your death. And that sounds like a very macabre sort of concept, earning your death. But what he was saying was, you have to earn your death by confronting with vigor the conundrum of life, which is we are hurtling toward the grave from the minute that we are born, and we have a very limited time to justify the oxygen that we stole from others. And so in your time, figure out how you're going to do that.
That's great. I would say, care about something so much that all of the people in your circle, in your ecosystem, that if I ask them what is it that you care about, they know. If the people around you have to guess and wonder what it is that you care about, I call BS on you caring about it. Like, you couldn't know me in any way and guess what I care about, because you see me fight against police brutality and mass incarceration. I know what every person on this stage cares about, not because they told me, but because I see them. And my wish, my hope for each of you is not that you pick my cause, that you pick police brutality or mass incarceration. If you do, great. My hope is that you pick something and believe in it so deeply, be it the climate crisis, be it human rights somewhere in the world, whatever the issue is that you choose, that everybody around you knows that that's your issue, because you're living a life that's so intentional, so on purpose, that it's just clear. And I say that as someone who took nearly 35 years to get to that point. It's a journey, and you can change your mind. You can pivot to new issues. And then lastly, I'll say that if you're struggling to pick just one issue, of course you are, because there's so much evil and so much despair around the world. How I try to flesh that out is, while I've picked my one issue, is I also try to support and amplify and encourage and high five and donate other people who've picked issues that are very different than mine. The truth is, you can only effectively fight but so many battles, but you can always support and amplify others who have made a decision that's different than yours, but they're in the fight as well.
I think I kind of said my advice already, which is to defend people, to speak out for people who are under attack. I mean, I was telling Linda, you know, we're actually often therapists. You know, we're lawyers, and people are calling us for legal help, but our number one job is to be therapists, because it's traumatizing to be attacked personally in these ways. And we have so many people coming to us in crisis. And when they know we have their back, it makes a huge difference. But when they see other people calling them and checking on them and standing up for them and writing about it, and that's what keeps people going. That's what lets people know that they can continue to do this work and not be destroyed.
That's right.
So it's so important, when you see these things happening, to speak out and reach out and speak out again, so that it will also come back to you. I mean, if you hear Mark Lamont Hill talk about, you know, who called him when he was under fire, that's what people remember, and that's what that's the kind of solidarity and the kind of support that we all need to keep doing this work.
We love our dear brother Mark. I tell you, he's a courageous brother, very much so. No, for me, very briefly, though, it has to do with the, how do you hold on to honesty in the face of deception, courage in the face of repression, decency in the face of insult, and then with the voice of the integrity in the face of oppression. And you're going to fail. I mean, Beckett says, try again, fail better. That's the story of our lives. No messianic role for anybody. The question is leaving the world a little better. Our Jewish brothers and sisters talk about it in terms of tikkun olam, to amend the world. Now, I'm a revolutionary Christian, so I heard in Vacation Bible School, as if the kingdom of God is within you, then everywhere you go, you ought to leave a little heaven behind. And that heaven has to do with the struggle for justice and finding joy in that struggle. So you're a blues person. all the catastrophe coming at you, and you're soulful, which is the sharing of a soothing sweetness against the backdrop of the grim catastrophe, but with a smile and style, with others throwing down and being willing to go down fighting and pass it on to the younger generation. And I'm the oldest brother here, more gray, less wise, still swinging, but joyful to see all these young folk throwing down, I'm telling you.
I'm about to turn 40, but I feel about 85. Let me tell you. I said this, I shared this quote at the last time when I was here at UMass Amherst, and I literally carried it around with me in my notebook, and I just wanted to share it with everyone here because I really, it really like speaks to the moment. It's by abolitionist Harriet Beecher Stowe. And she says, when you get into a tight place and everything goes against you till it seems as though you could not hang on a minute longer, never give up then, for that is just the place and time that the tide will turn. And the tide, sisters and brothers, is turning. I want to welcome to the stage Rachel Weber of JVP Western Mass, fabulous activist and attorney who represented us in court and continues to represent us in court here. And Shazia, who is the lead here of Students for Justice in Palestine. We're all members of JP.
Hi, everybody. I don't have the words to express how honored I am to be up here tonight with you. I am here with Jewish Voice for Peace. We're a national organization that is inspired by Jewish tradition to advocate for justice, peace, and self-determination for Palestinians, for Israelis, and for all of us, for everyone. So I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about the current anti-BDS legislation that is before the state of Massachusetts right now. But before I do that, I just wanna say, you know, so we've been hearing a lot that there's this misconception that Jews as a whole don't support BDS. And in Jewish Voice for Peace, we see it as our duty to raise our voices to upend that misconception, because it's happening in our names, it's happening with $3.8 billion a year in American tax dollars. And listening tonight to these panelists, what we heard from Omar Barghouti, from Linda Sarsour, from Dima Khalidi, from the Palestinians up here, think about how much time they had to spend tonight talking about the difference between anti-Semitism and criticism of Israel. That isn't a burden they should not be carrying. That is a burden for American Jews and Jews around the world to be carrying. That's work we need to be doing. That is not work for Palestinians to do. And so we need to take that work up so that the burden is taken off of them. So the current anti-BDS legislation before the Massachusetts legislature, it's called House 2719. It's called an act prohibiting discrimination in state contracts. Now, as Dima said, it's the third time that this legislation has come up before the legislature. The first time, they tried to do a sneak attack. There was a coalition of people, including JVP, including the Alliance for Water Justice in Palestine, Massachusetts Peace Action. They happened to be at the State House addressing a water crisis in Ramallah, and suddenly there were aides running up and down the hallway, calling their names because relationships they had built over years. And they said, they're trying to push something right now in the last 2 hours of session as a rider on a labor bill. Like, no one knew this was coming, total surprise. And in 2 hours, the networks that were able to mobilize brought in enough phone calls to the state legislature that they had to take it off from consideration. So that was time number one. Time number two was in 2017. They actually went through the appropriate channels, introduced it. There were some congressional hearings. The bill was defeated in committee. And it's the exact same text of the bill that was defeated in committee in 2017 is up again before the Massachusetts legislature. So in particular, the act specifies that the state will not contract with entities who discriminate based on, among other categories, national origin. I mean, that sounds pretty all right, right? except that despite the generic title of the bill and despite the absence of the words Israel or Palestine or BDS in the text of the bill was actually written for the very specific purpose of imposing penalties for participating in BDS. And that includes businesses that might participate in BDS. That also could include individuals like myself. I'm a criminal defense attorney and I contract with the state through the Public Defender's Agency. It could include state university employees. We know that the bill was written for that purpose because that's how the people who introduced the bill talk about it. So in 2017, Representative Howitt, when he initially introduced this measure, he said, and I quote, "This bill clarifies to businesses that either support BDS or who boycott Israeli-owned businesses and products that the Massachusetts of Massachusetts will not engage in commerce with them." And the bill was also described in this way by its supporters, like the Jewish Community Relations Council in Boston, who've expressed their deep disappointment that the bill failed in 2017. And said that all the bill would have done is allowed Massachusetts to stand by, quote, its values and not contract with people who engage in, quote, the noxious BDS movement. So the bill itself and its supporters and its legislative history, it's absolutely about BDS despite the language on its face, and it absolutely contains gross mischaracterizations of what the movement for BDS is about. And as we heard about tonight, what the movement for BDS is about not funding complicity in oppression. So that's the first thing, that the bill is 100% about BDS. The second thing, it violates the First Amendment. There's simply no question about it. So the bill very clearly impinges on right to engage in boycott, which is a time-honored and constitutionally protected method of protest, used indeed here, right here in Massachusetts, during the boycotts of South Africa. There was a successful boycott campaign in Massachusetts against Polaroid and its workers here in Massachusetts. So Massachusetts knows about boycotts. Now, at the time that Massachusetts bill was officially introduced in 2017, the ACLU testified against it, along with professors in the First Amendment from Harvard University, from Columbia University, and many other organizations like the Center for Constitutional Rights and Defending Rights and Dissent submitted statements against the bill. Bills just like it have been blocked in federal courts, like Kansas, Arizona, and Texas. And in particular, the Arizona and Texas bills also use this language of national origin. Now, in both cases, the court said, yeah, we know you're using the phrase national origin, but clearly the actual aim of this bill is to undermine the BDS movement, and like those laws, the bill in front of Massachusetts would require Massachusetts citizens to choose between a state job and participation in BDS. And that is constitutionally impermissible. You can't be forced to choose like that. By the way, the bill is also completely redundant because people who contract with state already have to sign under penalties of perjury that they will not discriminate. And finally, I just want to say that, just like Dima was saying, this is a slippery slope. This is part of a right-wing agenda to silence protest in this country. But really, wherever there is government, we need to fight for our right to protect it. And that's regardless of who's in the White House, right? But it's made particularly stark under the Trump administration with these anti-protest bills, efforts to criminalize indigenous resistance. This is all part of the same thing. And so any efforts right now to curb anyone's right to engage in peaceful protest should be seen for what it is. It's a threat on all of us who might find ourselves living their values by participating in dissent. Now, what can you do? On November 19th next week, there's a congressional hearing in Boston at the State House. Several of us from JVP are going, several folks from Students for Justice in Palestine are going. We have more information about it at our JVP table. And also the day before, November 18th, we're doing a phone blitz of Representative Carlos Gonzalez. He's the person closest to us geographically who is on the Joint Committee on State Administration and Regulatory Oversight, which is seeing the bill. Also at our table, you'll also see some information about what Omar was talking about with the Deadly Exchange campaign. So please, there are efforts to resist. We're working on this together, and the more the merrier. So please join us.
Hey, everyone. So my name is Natalie Amazon. I'm a senior here at UMass. I'm a double major in political science and legal studies with a minor in Afro-American studies. And I'm a proud member of our Students for Justice in Palestine here.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Hello. My name is Sazi Patel. I am a current sophomore here at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. I'm a social thought and political economy and BDIC double major. My BDIC concentration is community organizing in an international perspective, and I'm a very, very proud member to be applying the skills I'm learning in class to the work that SJP is doing here on our campus. So I want to first start off by thanking all of you for being here with us today, and especially a huge thank you to all of our six outstanding panelists who took the time out of their busy schedules to join us tonight as we all think and discuss the issues surrounding the factual occurrence of the criminalization of BDS and its dangerous implications on American democracy. So,
we know from our history and the continual struggle for justice and against white supremacy that protests and dissent are integral to achieving a world where people can live freely in their identities. As you've heard from our panelists in the intro video, the blatant attack and overt criminalization of people supporting boycott, divestment, and sanctions is the norm of our country. We can no longer let that be the case. Considering the fact that our money through our taxes goes to bolstering the apartheid regime of Israel, and that we are witnessing in real time the displacement and the destruction of people and their right to exist, means that we cannot be silent. 2 years ago, I was so scared of talking about Palestine. I didn't want to be labeled anti-Semitic. I didn't want to have any of that backlash. But I have that responsibility, and we have the responsibility in this room to speak truth to power and amplify the needs of Palestinians occupied and in the diaspora. This is what BDS is. It is engaging in boycotts, a traditional nonviolent tactic of social movements throughout history, including here in our country, which made it possible for me in 2019 to attend this predominantly white institution and talk with you all tonight. BDS, it's divestment from the resources that make this occupation possible and normalized. And it is sanctioning Israel for routinely engaging in human rights abuses with impunity.
So I quickly want to talk about what happened a couple of weeks ago, right? Many of us read the Chancellor's statement that he released and have been feeling very alienated and disillusioned on this campus. His statements did not take into account the illegal military occupation of Palestinians by the racist, white supremacist, settler colonial apartheid regime that is the Israeli government. His statement failed to take into account the feelings of Palestinian students and faculty on our campus who go through each and every day to defend their identities as Palestinians in a world that tries to erase that. The Chancellor's statement also failed to take into account our anti-Zionist, Black, Muslim, and other students of color and faculty whose struggle for liberation is directly tied in the U.S. to the liberation of Palestinian people in Palestine. In an age marked by strict scrutiny for people who advocate on behalf of and speak out for Palestinian freedom, the words of the Chancellor jeopardized our safety of our group and of our community members who support BDS and see it as an act necessary by his public demonization of the work that we do here on this campus. To all of our students and faculty members, and especially to our Palestinian students and faculty members who read this statement and are feeling and questioning what their place here on this campus is, I just want to say really quickly to you all that we see you, we hear you, and we are working to create a campus where you belong. Though we claim to be a university that is inclusive and diverse and a place for everyone, time and time again, this university has failed its most marginalized communities. And words mean nothing if they aren't backed by actions. But I hope that you all will find comfort to know that SJP is doing the very important and necessary work to amplify our collective struggles and our collective liberation work that we all are doing right now.
And this battle for justice in Palestine directly connects to the struggle for global liberation from white supremacy and neocolonialism. We live in a world where the fates of marginalized peoples are linked together. The plight of occupied Palestinians and the settler colonial state of Israel is paralleled with the battle for justice, self-determination, and the recognition of people's humanity in Iraq, in Sudan, Kashmir, Haiti, Flint, New York City. Today, we are seeing the world rise up to fight for our collective freedom. In all these conversations towards a liberated globe, Palestine will inevitably be at this table.
So these global issues are not abstract that are and far away struggles that are being waged by people that we don't know, but these are issues that manifest themselves on our campus and are that our peers are living through each and every day. We see this when acceptance rates of brown and black students every year goes down and public higher education becomes costly every year, pushing out students of color and low-income students on our campus. We see this when cultural centers at our university have to fight to stay open. We see this when graduate housing is being demolished, displacing so many. We see this when racist incidents happen time and time again and ineffective actions by our administrations are taken. Moments of recognition and resonance is how we build community and how we stand in solidarity with each other and how we push intersectional liberation. And that is to say that the work that SJP is doing on this campus is directly related and intertwined with all of the things I just listed.
To wrap it up, because we gotta wrap this up. I just wanna say to all the students out here, if you are at all interested in being a part of SJP, just getting to know what we're all about, please come to our meetings. We meet every Thursday, 6 o'clock in New Africa House in the basement, room 21. And for all the older folks in the room right now, as Shaun King says, as students, our bank accounts are looking a little dry. We did not get a budget this year, so if anyone in this room has some extra resources and would like to donate to our Venmo, it's SJP-UMass. That's SJP-UMass. Thank you so much. Continue.
So, thank you. Give it up to SJP and JVP. Give it up for yourselves for being out here tonight at this great event. Shout out to Tim Wai, Shaun King, Dima Khalidi, Dr. Cornel West, the great folks at MEF. We will not back down. We will not be silenced. We will not be intimidated. We will continue to speak truth to power, and we will win back our democracy in 2020. Good night. Oh, and thank you so much to Omar, who I just told him to take off the screen earlier. He is literally 3 o'clock in the morning in Palestine. Love to our brother Omar. Have a good night. Be safe, everybody. Take care of one another. Watch out for one another.
We need.